All right, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We are starting the afternoon session of day one of the MAG meeting. I will hand it over to the chair, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Changatai, and thank you everybody for coming back quite promptly too. I want to take one moment and just maybe in a slightly more relaxed, close out the last session. Obviously, there was a lot of context and a lot of content shared and no closure on the proposal for next steps. So all we simply said is that we would come back and revisit that after we are well enough advanced in the more immediate pressing need of dealing with the planning for the next IGF. That will probably be in a virtual meeting, and we can certainly continue the discussion on the MAG list. I suppose for good behavior, if we got through absolutely everything we needed to in the next day and a half, we could come back to it tomorrow. But I have to say that I think that's unlikely given the task ahead of us. So for those that were online in the room here, it was pretty obvious that there were a difference of opinions in terms of what the next step was. And I think we all know that those conversations don't close down quickly. And I think we should give it the time it deserves and set aside proper time for it. So with that, I think we've had two more online MAG members, or two more MAG members come in that are participating online who'd like to do a quick introduction. We'll do that, and then we'll move to the next portion of the agenda. So Anya.
Thank you very much. We have Giacomo. Giacomo, if you could speak now, although it doesn't seem that he's connected to audio. I guess we'll have to come back to Giacomo later. There is also Sylvia. So Sylvia, you have a floor. If you could speak now. I think we'll have to come back to this. Thank you.
Okay, and please do have them come in. As I said, I'm appreciative of anybody who takes the effort to participate online, because it just is not the best. So I do want to make sure that we're aware of who they are and they get a chance to introduce themselves just as we all did. So at this point in the agenda, we need to move on and start to get some of the specific modalities of this next IGF meeting. I'm going to do something a little bit out of order. I mean, normally we would have had a high-level discussion on general shaping of the meeting, main themes, and that sort of thing, and then we move in a layered approach into a more detailed discussion later. I actually think we had a lot of good discussions yesterday and some this morning. I think our process is evolving a little bit in that we are hoping to rely, and I think are going to be able to rely a lot more on a lot of the intersessional activities. So whether that's the national and regional IGF initiatives, or it's best practice or dynamic coalition work, or in fact the connecting the next billion. And I want to make sure that we give time for some of those inputs to come in a little bit later in the afternoon, when hopefully we'll be in a position to start to move into some of the sort of themes and sub-themes. What I thought would help at this point would be to, and let me just talk a little bit about what I would like to get through today. And we can open that up quickly for kind of comments or agendas. I think it makes sense at this point in the process to talk a little bit about the timeline we're facing, because there are some natural constraints here, given we're starting quite late in the year. And we're going into, in a few short months, the summer vacation period in the Northern Hemisphere. And I think we need to take that into account. If we can look at that, get a sense of the timeline that we're talking about, if we can close on some of the key things, such as when we would be looking to evaluate the proposals that have come in, and when we would have our physical meeting to do that. And then I think there's a need for a third meeting as well. If we can get those things agreed quite quickly, then that's great. If not, at least we have the overall frame in mind, and we can come back and start to look through some of the other components, which I think at that point would then be to start to get some discussion on workshop formats, guidelines, and criteria. And at which point I would ask, I guess, Victor and maybe Chengatai to give us a little bit more insight into the facilities that are there so that we understand what, if any, impact they actually have on our planning, whether it's main session, workshop, types of workshops, or what's facilitated. I know that Virat, on the basis of some discussions with various people the last couple of days, has kindly put together some tools. There were tools that I think we developed a little bit on the fly last year. So the good news is we're bringing the tools forward in a more systematic manner this year. But again, I think for those that are new to the MAG, seeing some of those graphics will just help people understand kind of the overall frame that we're actually working with in here. Another thing we need to do today is to get the workshop criteria guidelines, possibly agreement on the format. Agreed if we can. We have a great body of work from the past years that we can use as a basis. If not, I might ask a small group of people to go away and look at that tonight or tomorrow morning and come back into the room tomorrow morning with a proposal. Because the one thing we do need to have agreed before we leave tomorrow is the workshop proposal format guidelines. We need to be clear enough on the guidelines for the criteria for our review of the proposals. I think we can stop short and not have the specific discussion yet on how that review is actually done and some of the specific rating criteria. I think we can actually do that as a part of a virtual meeting offline. So, I mean, I think there's a couple of really kind of core pillars, if you will, of the work we need to do that we could actually get through today. And if there was a really good win behind us, we could even start a discussion on sort of themes and sub-themes and main sessions. But I think there's enough time to get through a lot of that tomorrow. One of the, maybe this is my last comment, one of the other things we looked at in the Secretariat on the basis of discussions with many of you in the room, but also a lot of the participants that have supported all the intersessional work, is in the past we've had themes, sub-themes. In fact, last year we went out for a public comment review, all the luxury of time, came back in, finalized it, and then put out the call. We obviously don't have that luxury this time, so if we can get strong enough agreement on it now to go forward, we can go forward, perhaps plan on making some minor adjustments after the workshop proposals come in. Another alternative that we looked at would be to do some partial framing. There's probably a couple of areas that we would all agree are absolutely areas that we want to focus and really feature in the conference, and we can be quite clear on those. We may want to leave some flexibility for some other ideas to come in through the submissions or the proposals, and we finalize some portion of those themes at our next meeting. So I think we have some flexibility and some leeway, and yet we'll still be in a position to give enough specific guidance and direction to manage the call for workshop proposals, which, as I said, I think you'll see in a few moments, our goal really is to get that out no later than next week. And the Secretariat and I had a real stretch goal of this week, in fact. But stretch goals are good. You know, having the fallback is probably even better. So I think, let me just see if everybody's, if that seems sensible and if you could follow it. Does it make sense as an approach? I'm sure there'll be no reluctance to object later on if it's less than helpful. So maybe at this point, Lewis, do you have the timeline? I think is probably the best one.
Sure, thank you, Chair. We are going to project it in the screen.
Virat, did you want to introduce it? You have the benefit of...
I sent one, so if they could... I don't know which one they're pulling up. So
that is the one.
Yeah. So if you could just move it up a little bit. Should I share? So given the very compressed timeline, this is what, after a discussion last night, just a proposal for us to look at how we can try and get this thing going. And what we also need to remember that we need to give workshop organizers about 3 months to get, after the proposal is submitted, to get everything in order, because usually what they have is names of speakers and structure and all of that stuff, but it takes about 2 months of work to finally nail it down. There are some last minute changes, etc. If we can finalize broad themes, not specific themes, but broad themes, one of the recommendations could be going back to the 4 broad themes, and we could do more sub-themes under that. But as you know, IGF has always had broad themes: security, accessibility, diversity, and there's one more. So we can pick those and sort of, you know, agree on that. But that's, you know, that may or may not be that easy, but you need to have basic broad themes indicated for proposals to be made out and submitted under the subheads. We certainly...
Vera, just a quick comment. I saw a few people taking pictures and things. It is actually posted on the website under the documents.
And it's just a proposal. We might change
but,
it.
But so. At least people will be able to see it and move back and forth.
Yeah, just go to the front page under the tab with the documents. Yeah, you can see it. Input documents.
And please remember, it's only a proposal to the MAG. We can change it, shift it around, depending on what everybody thinks. We can finalize the criteria, as the chair mentioned earlier. That's absolutely necessary, otherwise we won't have our work finished. The evaluation procedure, this is basically for us to understand how to rank it 1 to 5. And tips for finalizing great workshop, a fantastic document that was done last year by the working group. Chair, I would recommend it sort of after I finish, when we actually put up some of these documents. I know Susan will be reluctant because she's a former MAG member, but we should really invite her for a short period to present those documents, because she's really the lead of the working group, which did some outstanding work along with Fiona. So after we leave here, then we hope to put out the open call for workshops on the IGF website, like each year, on the 15th of April. We have 9 days after we leave here to do that. Given the squeezed time period, we are looking at giving 6 weeks to proposals to be submitted. Normally we give up to 2 months. I know the secretariat would be happier if we gave 2 months, but less is better. So 6 weeks is what is being given. As a proposal, we could bring it up, down, whatever we feel like, and decide to do, and what is appropriate. Secretariat then organizes and sends proposal to the MAG for evaluation. They need about a week, but 10 days, just putting some margin everywhere. So that's June 9th. MAG has 11 days to complete its evaluation. The process of evaluation, as the chair mentioned, can be discussed, but we do have an established process for evaluation right now, where all the members rate proposals, and based on that rating, there's a cutoff for the first 100, and then we relook at those when we come back on 30 to 30, and then a cutoff is organized. Now, there could be an extra step here or additional piece, or maybe they need some extra time. We can discuss that. And so after that is done on 1st of July, then given the 4th of July weekend, was recommending that people could, you know, try and be here 6th to the 8th.
And also the ICANN meeting.
Yeah, the ICANN meeting as well, which is in the last week of June, which means the members of the MAG who are involved with ICANN would have done the evaluation before the ICANN meeting begins. Again, just recommended dates, and trying to finish it in the first week of July, so that Europe then goes on vacation starting second week, and so that kind of becomes a difficult phase to work through. This will give us and our workshop organizers, it gives us nearly 3 months to complete the process, and it gives the workshop organizers another 3 months to get everything nailed down. So this is just for the consideration of the MAG and open to comments. Thank you. And I haven't shared with Changatai, so he might have some comments to begin with.
I'll just like to say, I mean, my stuff may groan, but we can do the sorting and the rankings much, much quicker. It's basically automatic, and then we just do some manual checking, but we don't need 10 days. We can compress those times.
Okay, good. If we can, then we can give more time back to workshop organizers, but I think 6 weeks should be enough, I suppose. Unless the MAG feels otherwise, 6 weeks should be. Well, let's have comments.
I have just a very, it's Marilyn Cade. I just have a very quick comment. This is extremely helpful, and I want to thank you for doing it. But I just want to make a comment about the experience that I had. And I think in the past, occasionally, we've had an extra day or two built in for flexibility in case something catastrophic happens and we need to give an extension. And I just would say, even though I know the Secretariat is being extremely generous to all of us, I think that building in a day or two safeguard here and there, if we can do it, would make me feel more comfortable. And I don't know what I think the catastrophic event would be, but I'll use as an example the time I got ashed in Brussels and wasn't able to be either in line or online or anything else because I was living at the airport for 10 days, due to a climate event. So a little flexibility here and there. Otherwise, this looks really good in terms of it's very sequential. But I think we would need to really make commitments as MAG members that we're going to meet these deadlines and do our virtual calls.
Can I just make one more point before we invite the next comment? I have worked in about one or two days into each of those deadlines for providing space and yet tried to finish it in the first week of July. Now, I remember last year the MAG asked for more time, I think twice. Yes. Or at least once or twice, yes. I think. So the MAG itself was the reason to ask for more time.
Luis, could I ask you to put the table back up? And I think there are at least two critical points on it. One is, how does the MAG feel about the time for workshop proposals, which in this timetable is 6 weeks? And how does the MAG feel about the evaluation time of 2 weeks? And at some point, you need to note exactly when those 2 weeks are and look at your own calendars and make sure you're committing to it. So those are the two things I'd like to hear from the floor at the moment, and maybe we'll take first the 6 weeks for workshop proposals. Andrea, with exception, okay.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just, from experience, having started organizing workshops for IGF since 2007, there is never enough time. And the thing is, from my specific experience of running a dynamic coalition, I run a democratic group. I have members all over the world, and we work by reflector. And we have conference calls, which have to be captioned and paid for in order to get everybody to agree to one thing. 6 weeks is making it very tight. And I'll just go, only I can go from my experience, and I've always had to ask for extra time because of the fact that I run a democracy. So I would prefer to have what we had last year, which I believe was 8 weeks, was it not? I think
it was about 8 weeks, and we also had about 11 months, so yeah, that was the difference.
Thank you.
Maybe we could split the difference and go for 7 weeks if we can actually get the call out this week and not require all of next week. I'll put that forward in the spirit of a compromise. Sala, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. This is Sala for the record. I'd just like to say it would be a different, I suppose two of the documents that are supposed to be hyperlinked in there, are they two documents that were developed from the workshop last year?
Those are different, but these are just deadlines, so that's
right.
A different document.
But it's sort of related. If they had been handed to us prior to this meeting, then the April 6th date would be justified. So I would submit that things. I know that we need to finalize and find a wrap it up fast. But just given the nature of the exhaustion, and even though work has already been done on it from last year, but to do justice, you would need at least, say maybe 48 hours to look at it and to allow remote MAG participants who are not here to sort of consolidate it and say, okay, this is fine. So I would say instead of the April 6th that you move it to April 8th, enough time to allow for our remote MAG members who are not here to consolidate the criteria so that in terms of moving forward, that we don't, you know, you don't get backlash. That's just sort of one suggestion. The second thing is, I'd like to commend Virat for the excellent work in actually putting together a table. Really cuts down time. So that's really awesome. Yes, that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Sala. Liesl, you have the floor.
Thank you. I really would leave it to others to talk about the time periods between the 6th and the 8th of July based on the experience of continuing MAG members. So I really appreciate their guidance there and the considerations that we have. But one thing I would like to react to is the number one, unfinalizing the sub-themes. That has traditionally taken quite a bit of time from the MAG meetings and the intersessional MAG meetings to finalize the sub-themes. So along with that and the conversations that we've had, I think the comments that have been made over the course of the last day and a half are that perhaps the sub-themes could be more developed from a bottom-up process by the workshop submissions based on topics or tags or some mechanism for deriving the sub-themes from the submissions we actually get rather than dictating them in the next day and a half. Perhaps the context of the bottom-up and saving us a little bit of time in the next day and a half, we could possibly take one off and put it to the sub-theme development along with the evaluation of the workshop criteria, the workshop workshop space, and then putting them into sub-themes that make sense at the appropriate meeting. Thank you.
Could I just want to explain the point on sub-themes. So you're right, every year we take time to develop sub-themes, but usually it's done during a course of a MAG meeting. In this case, what is being suggested is to go back to the four broad sub-themes that have existed with the IGF since its inception. And everybody can then submit their proposals, as you've said, and use that to build the final sub-themes under the four broad sub-themes. Now, almost all topics are usually covered under those sub-themes, not indicating anything by way of sub-themes makes it difficult to put out a call by the 15th of April, because then you'll have 40 different types of topics which can't be clustered unless they know how under which broad theme they have to put in. So a safe space for us is to play with the four broad sub-themes that have existed since the inception of MAG, and you're absolutely right, then once they come in under those four heads, then we can put them under sort of sharper themes and develop that over a virtual call period. That was the submission as it was prepared. That's all. But the call needs to give some indication, I think, of where the, especially first-time proposers, should put in. The people who are professional writing this stuff, have done this before, will know that go under cybersecurity, go for net neutrality. They understand this stuff. Those who haven't done it, first-timers, which is the ones who we are trying to encourage, need to have some broad idea. So that was the point. Thanks.
So we're kind of doing a tour de table, I think, here of themes, timetables, workshop guidelines, and
that's possibly a very good thing for everybody to get a sense of what's in front of us, and then we come back and close. Just to stay with the themes and sub-themes for a moment, we've actually had a lot of indication from the letter from the UN Secretary General and the support in this room for linking it to the SDGs. We had some very good input this morning from the host country. We've had input, some and still more to come, from some of the intersessional work. So I think we've got some broad things there as soon as we settle into that conversation that will help us advance quite quickly to a good portion of it, even if not all of it, which should give us guidance and maybe leave a little room for flexibility. When I look at the timetable here, I think I've identified three possible points of maybe extra capacity in terms of moving around. I don't hear anybody saying there's some component piece of this that just doesn't work. I think we've said possible we don't need quite so much time in the Secretariat for some of those steps. If we had to, we could probably move it out to the third week of July. I'm not sure that makes an awful lot of difference for many of the MAG members. It's something we could test. And then we've got a little bit of time here on the front end if we made good progress the next 2 days on. So there's three more people, I think, in the queue, or however many. We'll come to those and try and close in this session for a moment. And then maybe we can come to a discussion on, I'd like to get to some of the workshop guidelines, criteria, and proposals, let people look at those and get a sense of what's there already, what exists, and how much work we need to do to finalize that, and then we can possibly come back. But so let me, we've had a list here. Murad, you are next on the list.
Thank you. I have two comments regarding the timetable. The first one is, regarding the evaluation by the MAG members of the proposals, I'm wondering if 11 days are enough, supposing the case we have hundreds, not 200, but hundreds of proposals. Would it be enough for us and how to proceed? The second comment regards the projected, the prospected meeting scheduled in July. It's a bit confusing for me. We are talking about 3 days meeting, but for the duration, it was noted 7 days. So it's a bit confusing. Thank you.
The 7 day period is the period ending when the Secretariat submits the final workshops, and you will have it in your hand for 7 days. But the duration, I'm sorry, it should say the duration of the meeting is 3 days, but the MAG will have 7 days after the listing of 1 to 243 or whatever is done to read that, because when we come back in the room, there is then this face-to-face discussion, especially with regards to areas which are missing. For example, last year, intergovernmental proposals were disproportionately lower, and so work had to be done to bring up some of those proposals. So that's, it's, you're right, I'm sorry, it should have been 3 days, and 7 days is the run-up.
It may be easier to just look at the deadline column. I'm a little confused myself on the duration. So, Hossam, you have the floor.
Yeah, just a suggestion. If we can move the meeting, the MAG meeting, for a few days to start like 11th of July, because we have, for Muslims, they have fasting that will be ending on the 6th or 7th of July. Thank you.
Thank you, Hossam. Sila, you have the floor.
I just want to ask about the, we mentioned that we might ask some proposals to be merged together. At which stage it will happen to inform the people proposing those workshops to merge two or three workshops together? At which stage, and then maybe we should review the timing, because we have to give them time to contact each other and decide. And my second question is, how many workshops can the host accommodate during those 2 days? We have to take this also into consideration when we want to set the evaluation criteria.
No, that's true, and we'll come to that point in a moment. Main sessions falls somewhat into that discussion as well. To your first question, it's as soon as the MAG has finished their work and selected them as a part of that process, they identify which workshop proposals they believe are potentials for mergers, and then the Secretariat goes away and facilitates that. So in this model, it would be mid to late July.
If I could just, so when we meet on, let's say it was 6 to 8 July, for argument's sake, the MAG will identify clear, let's say there's a space for 90, 100 proposals, let's say, for argument's sake, hopefully less, but let's say 100 proposals. The MAG would say 90 are absolutely clean, must go ahead. 10 proposals are looking really good, and there are another 7 or 8 which are also looking good but didn't score high. So now we're going to have facilitators bring these proposals together. So it happens at the end of our meeting, and we have 4 months. But what you have to do is try and do the merger in about a 2 or 3 week period, because there is a cutoff of 100. So you've got 10 and then another 6 or 7 that need to be merged. Usually it's about 10 to 15 that have to be merged together to be brought down to, let's say, 9. That's the normal experience. But that'll start on 8th of July in this case.
In this case, we have to review another time the merged proposals, no?
No. No, that, I mean, okay. Those, then what we could do this year, we haven't done in the past, and there was a good suggestion, was that a working group can be formed, because mergers don't happen easily. It's very difficult. People don't want to change speakers. They don't want to dilute their point. There are proposals on cybersecurity and cybersecurity, which the MAG sees are similar, but the proposal submitters see are totally different. So what we could do is form a working group at that stage who will help facilitate the mergers. But it'll have to be after you've done the cutoff.
So thank you. In the queue, we have Marilyn, Cheryl, and then Michael. Marilyn, you have the floor.
Thank you. Marilyn Kate speaking. I'm gonna take 30 seconds to ask everybody a really big favor. You may not always notice this, but if you could pay attention to the transcript and whether or not your name is reflected, it's really very helpful, because later when you're reading the transcript and it says woman speaking, somebody else may be getting credit for your great comment. But seriously, because we have so many new MAG members, it would be really helpful if people could just pay particular attention to that. Not why I took the floor, however. Prior to becoming a MAG member, I had each year worked with or coached different groups, including new groups, who proposed workshops. And last year, I found the work that the MAG did to try to provide guidance and a template approach almost really, really helpful. But I also found that brand new proposers really benefited from having at least a little structure to fit into. They were confused. Well, does it fit in privacy? Does it fit in security? Does it fit here? Does it fit there? And in some cases, they became even more confused because we weren't clear in setting limits from the very beginning by being very honest with people. There will be no more than 101 workshops, hypothetically, or 79, hypothetically. And we incented people to spend a lot of time drafting workshop proposals, going out and contacting speakers, giving us 2 or 3 page well-developed proposals when there was no chance that we were going to be able to accept 270 workshops. I experienced a lot of negative feedback from the brand new proposers, a lot of frustration, phone calls with someone who was in tears over being, so here's what I would say. The more we can set the limits up front and make them clear, set the expectations up front, allow perhaps a track of more flexibility, do things like a fact sheet, do things that help people to assess ahead of time,
but also be clear that we aren't just filling those rooms with workshop proposals, we're also filling them with open forums. And so we have to take that into account in our total space allocation. I'll just say one other thing. If we're going to talk about experimenting with new modalities, it's really important we understand what the venue can support. We could, for instance, look at the experience that the WISIS Forum is experimenting with on the TED Talk approach, see how it works by observing it from some of us who will be there during the WISIS Forum, and see if there's a way to use kind of a different approach to letting people who do not make it into the workshop slot still have an opportunity to participate in a unique way.
Thank you, Marilyn. I think those are good comments. I'll take the few comments that are still here, and then maybe at this point it would be appropriate to go to Victor so that we get some sense of the size of rooms, types of rooms, and what would be facilitated before we go into the workshop proposals and guidelines. Because if we really are in our mind thinking of TED Talk-like things or other innovations, I think it would be helpful to have a better idea of the facilities before we enter into the workshop proposals, criteria, and types of. So with that, I have Cheryl, Michael, Jivan, and online.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think what we have in front of us is very workable, and I definitely want to say thank you to Virat. It's quite organized. I think perhaps you should have been an accountant in a former life, because I certainly couldn't figure out all those dates. And I also think that the 11th, looking up there, it looks like that could definitely work, to Hassam's point. On the sub-themes, I agree. I talked to a lot of first-time proposers last year, and I think having sub-themes is helpful, especially, you know, sky's the limit with respect to what issue you can try to tackle. And so I think that'll also help to, you know, we want to get good proposals, and we want people to help people submit the best proposals that they can. Marilyn's comment about having resources, spot on. I mean, that was going to be my comment. I don't know. I don't think we did this last year, but I would also suggest, and I'm not trying to make more work, but perhaps having either a webinar or even a conference call where the community could call in and talk to MAG members and ask questions. They probably are questions that, you know, we know the answers to, but it might not be obvious for someone who's not gone through the process. It might help us with transparency as well. I also agree on the merger point. I think we definitely need to spend a minute discussing how we'll handle that, because my first year kind of within this process, the mergers that were left to happen on their own didn't really happen. And I think that it would be really useful to have almost someone kind of Sherpa the mergers along, because, you know, you might have two people, while they may be the same theme, they may have completely different ideas of the approach to what they're hoping to get out of their workshop or their flash session or what it might be. And that complicates the mergers as well, because we had some people who had, a panel, some people who had a round table. How do you merge two different ideas in that way? I think also once we are done with this, if we can come up with some really clear, simple online instructions, so that once people go to the website, it's very, you know, it's very basic and nothing's very confusing in terms of what we're looking for. And I think also perhaps if we think about for those who don't make it, and I know it's tough when you put so much work into something and you get rejected. Perhaps we can have a little bit, some resources around why no. I don't know if we can do something such as like a follow-up webinar or something, or, you know, something along the lines of giving some feedback in terms of if you were to resubmit this next year, what would help it to get across the finish line? Thank you very much.
I think the last point's a good suggestion. If I remember correctly, I think last year we did actually have some categories which allowed us to give some feedback, which that's a very important point.
May I also make a quick point? We did do webinars. I think Susan would be able to explain that, but we did have this top sort of 10 tips for submitting workshops, and a webinar was held inviting, and also the call went out in 10 different six different languages that really helped people. So I think that was done last year.
And we must repeat those this year. Michael, you were next. I just saw your hand go up. This is meant for MAG members, but I've got four or five other people in the queue as well. So, Michael, you were next.
Thank you. Just a couple of quick comments. I would really urge us to shorten the period that we allocate under number 7 for the Secretariat to evaluate the proposals. I think the MAG is going to need more than 11 days. 11 days would be fine if we didn't have any other jobs to do. But I note that time period includes Eurodig, includes some other important meetings that are going to take people away. As I recall last year, the Secretariat didn't have to spend that much time because you're mostly just eliminating duplicate proposals from the same person who submitted a second better one or ones that are just so clearly deficient. It takes 5 minutes to see that. So if there was a way to shorten that so that the evaluation by the Secretariat was done by June 4th or June 3rd so that all of us could work the weekend, that would give us more like 17 days, and I think that would be much more reasonable. I really concur with Cheryl's comment about the importance of doing the webinars both before and after, and I think we could probably do a better job of publicizing the webinar for people who haven't done it before. It's really hard to reach people who we don't know are going to propose, but we do hear a lot of complaints every year about, well, if I'd only known about some aspect of the proposal process, they would have been able to do a stronger proposal. The other thought I had was about getting people to propose earlier. And one, I'm trying to remember, I never had a reason to check, but when people propose 2 weeks before the deadline, did we post those at that point, or did we wait until all the proposals came in before revealing any of the proposals?
I think we wait for all the proposals to come in.
An option we might offer people is to have their proposal posted and shared.
As soon as they submit.
Give them the option. You know, if they've got a really cool proposal and they don't want anybody else to copy it, maybe they don't want to share it. But sometimes people put a really strong proposal out, but they're missing one or two slots. And sometimes they say, you know, we're trying to get somebody from Africa. That would allow people who are interested in the topic to jump on that proposal. The other thing that I've seen a lot is we'll have three great proposals on a particular topic, well thought out, but only really two panels worth of good people, and that forces us to merge them. But if instead somebody puts a proposal out there and people who are interested see that, they might merge themselves, so we avoid it. So it's a great way to get people. It's also a great way to show people a good proposal, because most people who are proposing early probably know what they're doing. So I've seen this work well in other cases. The last point was that I have a question for Victor, really, which is I do think we want to explore new formats. I love the TED Talk proposal. I've in the past advocated for debates. Another thing that we tried last week at RightsCon, Cloudflare organized an unpanel. So rather than having a bunch of people sit in front of the room, we introduced our 7 or 8 panelists and we sent them into the room, and you had all these small group discussions. It's something that the World Economic Forum does as well. And you could do this if you set up the room differently, but it would require having a room with 10 or 15 tables and having a lot of 10-person discussions. And then at the end of the session, everybody comes back and gets their 2 minutes. But that's a great way to engage people on topics, but it does require planning. So it's a question for Victor about the space.
So I have Jivan, online participants, and Arnold in the queue. And then we will come to Victor for some more insight into the facilities, and then we'll come back and pick this conversation up. I think that's a natural segue for that. Thank you, Michael. Jivan, you have the floor.
Thank you. I think that a lot of organizations apply for workshops because they want to promote themselves, and that's understandable. And and okay, especially if they have something to say, a new idea to, or a new issue to raise. But at the same time, I think that the most interesting workshops, at least for me, are the ones that, where there's a great debate, not just one person or like perhaps like two people or two groups kind of going around a given issue and presenting both sides of the policy possibilities. So I think that perhaps we should even make time or make space out of the workshops, perhaps a quarter or something like that, to organize them around questions that we formulate ahead of time. So if we go from the theme to the sub-theme level, at the level of sub-theme, for us to shape three questions that need to be answered, and then to invite people with positions on that, so that that would take away the need to curate afterwards or merge workshops, because the merging would have been done ahead of time with the concentration, with the focus of the questions that need to be answered. So that is just one recommendation, and I think that perhaps, you know, we can afford to give a quarter of the number of workshops to something like that, to that kind of a format. Then in that, I think that there's two types of issues that are raised. One are very generic issues that keep on being raised perhaps at every IGF since the beginning. As you've said, you know, the core infrastructure resources of the internet, et cetera, et cetera. And those are good for people coming into the debate to get a hold of where things are. We mentioned, I think last year, we had some experiments with it where people, experts, are put in a given space to answer some questions. So, I mean, some workshops can be, or space, it doesn't have to be workshops, can be framed in that kind. But others are where the new ideas, the new issues, the new problems need to bubble up. And for that, I think that we keep on being discussing of involving the national and the regional IGFs, and perhaps this is the opportunity to allocate another quarter to really have a structure already of the issues that are arising at the national and the regional IGFs, and for a space for them to debate them, for to be put into one group and then say, you know, the continental or the national or the regional IGFs present, and then, well, compare notes. You have these kinds of problems. Have you solved these kinds of problems? And for that to be moderated in some form, perhaps by the MAG, perhaps in by experts. But just I think that it's good for us to think of different kinds of formats. And having said that, again, for the third year in a row, I would say let's reduce the number of workshops. I think that, you know, even 60, I keep on mentioning this number 60, but like 60 seems like a good number of workshops. More than that, just like it's too much. You know, people are come in and they're lost in the sea of what all is being discussed. So much for now. Thanks.
Thank you, Jivan. Anya, for online participants.
Yes, thank you. Avery, you have the floor now.
Okay, thank you. This is Avery speaking, and I guess we're supposed to always give our affiliation, so I'm CS with a strong TC affinity. First of all, I want to give a comment against going back to the themes from last decade. I think those are well-worn, and what happens when we use those themes, in fact, what happens when we use any theme, is people take what they want to do and they try to stuff it in that box. And so we end up with things saying that they belong to a theme that really don't. I really like the notion of themes by induction that Liesl gave us. What it sort of does is it compresses both the bottom-up effort of going out to a community and say, give us themes, and then putting it together and saying, give us workshops. If we basically ask them to give us workshops, identify a theme, you know, and we can even say, look at previous themes if you don't know what kind to go, but basically identify, then basically taking that work and sort of finding out what are the themes, the actual themes that people want to talk about, and pulling it together from there. It sort of expedites the work given our short time and yet still allows for strong community participation. So I would really like to argue for that. I really do like the idea of having multiple webinars before, after, explaining things, putting ourselves on the line with the members of the community. I'm sort of nervous about the idea of putting together strong ones first, because then you get the strongest getting in line first, and that has the effect of very much taking the air out of the room. Oh, I could never do anything as good as that person did, their experience. And sort of it can actually have an inhibiting effect. So that I have a nervous feeling about. I truly do not believe that we should limit the workshops by anything other than time and available room, because we have to remember that what we're building is a very rich resource, that even after people go away, those things are there for them to listen to. So if we can sort of educate people that you go to the workshops where you feel you have something that you want to say, you can listen to all the others afterwards. And so I would like to argue that. So as I say, let themes emerge from the workshops. Let them suggest a thing. Let's not force everybody to pick a box and pretend that their workshop fits that box. Thank you.
Thank you, Avery. Jack has one intervention, if you allow. Jack, you can speak now.
Hi, this is... Okay, thanks, Anya. This is Jack. So I have several interventions because I've been collecting them throughout as we are discussing, so I hope you will just bear with me a little while. Firstly, I think 2 weeks is definitely not enough for evaluation. I think even if recognizing the tight turnaround, it's definitely going to be too difficult to try and do all of the workshop assessments within that period of time. 4 weeks would be half of last year, and I guess at a push with different kinds of approaches to workshop assessments, it might work. And also to take into account and take into consideration intersessional work for the MAG meetings, which will have an impact on the meetings. So, for example, there might be meetings for intersessional groups as well, so that to also bear in mind as you're planning for how do we make full use of the time for our next meeting. Then moving on to themes and sub-themes, I think that actually having some sort of sub-theme might be useful to frame the workshop proposals, especially for people who are new to the IGF process. I think if you sort of ask them to take and run, I think it might be a little bit difficult, although I'm not entirely opposed to the idea. But I do think it's probably a little bit useful to have at least some. And I do support the idea of sub-themes I do think that sub-themes from at least last year would be better than to try and pick sub-themes from the beginning of the incarnation of IGF, which might possibly be no longer quite so relevant. But I really love the idea of themes emerging from workshop proposals themselves. And I think Yanis also had the same proposal, and as I saw in the comment box, which is using tagging as a way to self-identify what you think your workshop is about. It's a very accepted and usual user-generated content convention online. It would be very workable. So to recommend this as part of the submission of your workshop proposal, what tag would you put? And maybe also to not just have the tagging in terms of content or topic tag, but also based on the level of the workshop. So for example, is this a beginner, intermediate, or advanced kind of a workshop that is being proposed? And then also supporting the idea of different formats. I think that's really great to try and experiment. I think we try to think about this every year. And I quite like the idea of the unpanel that was raised. And maybe the flip side of that is also to restrict speakers to numbers of sessions. So for example, either two or three at the maximum. Like you cannot be in six different workshop sessions plus two main sessions speaking. I think that's a little bit much. And then, fourthly, it's about giving an opportunity to respond to questions for workshop proposals. I think that's fantastic. But maybe to accompany webinars, or maybe instead of webinars, which might be difficult because you have to find people with the same time zone or to be able to have that kind of technical capacity to be participating in a webinar, to have a period where you can ask questions. So like maybe a week where all kinds of any questions you might have about the workshop our proposal, around the process, around et cetera, to collect all of this and then to take the time to respond to them all and come up with a kind of FAQ that people can refer to even if you miss webinars. Or this can be also as a product of the webinar. So it's a little bit more, I guess, tech-friendly and more archived in that sense. And finally, to bring up again the need to consider a space for protesters to express their concerns in the organizing of the IGF, so a kind of a space or a platform, not necessarily workshop. This usually happens at the closing session, but maybe we should think about programming this much more in a much more formal way, I guess. And that's it. Thanks.
Thank you, Jack. Very complete set of comments. Is there another online participant?
I've been asked to read one comment from Ginger Peck, which is actually a comment made by a former MAG chair, so if you allow. Maybe with four traditional sub-teams, MAG would like to introduce the text that would help organizers and users describe the sessions in more details. Just a thought. Moreover, text would be descriptive and would not be negotiated. That's the end of comment. Thank you.
Thank you. Since the last time I closed the queue, more flags have gone up. I will take those flags that are up, but then I'm going to draw a hard line under them for the moment, because I think at this point, before we go deeper, we really do need to get some more insight from Victor with respect to the facilities and hosts. I think that will perhaps further inform our discussion. So with that, Arnold, you've actually been very patient, so please, you have the floor.
Thank you, Lynn, and thank you, Firat, for this useful time frame proposal. I'm not going to comment whether this is all feasible, whether we need, as a MAC, 11 or 10 days to evaluate. However, I have a problem with number 10, the proposed dates to select the final workshops, as this is the holiday season in the Netherlands, at least in the Netherlands. At least I will be in the beautiful country of Portugal to celebrate my summer holiday, Anna. And but it would be a pity if I wouldn't be there to help select the workshops. If I'm the only one in the room of the MAG members and the others don't have a problem with it, that's a fact. I can cope with that. But again, it's a pity. Suggestion whether it is possible to postpone that until the beginning of September. I don't know, because we have postponed the IGF with a month compared to the IGFs of previous years, where it took place in the month of November. But it's up to you to comment on that. And my second point is this only one meeting as a MAC to finalize the program, or should we need another one, perhaps in the second half of this year? Thank you.
Okay, let me just give a quick comment on the other two. I think to postpone it to September is quite difficult, and I'm not sure it's fair to the workshop proposals, because it leaves them hanging for quite a long period of time. I'm not actually sure it buys us better evaluations, because if everybody's on holiday for August, they're not likely doing it in August either. And I think I think we're faced with July for the workshop proposal evaluation almost no matter how we cut it. If we cannot find a date that gives us most of the MAG in the room, because don't forget you actually do your evaluations outside the proposal, so we will have your input. What we might do is come out of the physical meeting with the workshop proposal done. Give 2 weeks for those people that weren't able to be in the room to evaluate what the final outcome is, raise any final comments or concerns, and then we address those by exceptions, which does at least give you another check-in point after having completed your evaluations. And I'll also just remind people that the way we do it is there's some fairly large number that are accepted because they've met criteria and they were scored so high. There's equally a number on the bottom that usually are not accepted, and there's some portion in the middle, which is where the MAG spends the bulk of its time. So, I think if we don't have enough people, or we have some strong objection to the date and people not being able to be in the room when the evaluation's done, I think at this point about the only fallback I can see is that we make the output of that physical meeting known and we give some additional time for those MAG members that weren't in the room to take a look, comment, evaluate, and we deal with any concerns or questions by exception. I'll leave that there and continue going around the, it is unfortunate, but I don't know how to take back time, and I don't think pushing it to September buys us anything. And we're likely, though, to have another meeting, probably in the September timeframe, which is probably when we finalize some of the other component pieces, some of the perhaps intersessional work, main sessions, and some of those things, or at least advance some of those even further. So with that, Ilya, you have the floor.
Thank you, Lynn. My name is, for the record, is Ilya, and I'm a new MAG member from Bulgaria. I have a small suggestion that we might want to consider. We can publicize the call for workshop proposals prior to the actual opening. This way people can start organizing themselves. Now, while we still finalize the process, something simple as coming soon, IGF 2016 call for proposals can help. It can be posted on Facebook, Twitter, on the website, and then each one of the MAG members can amplify via their own circles.
Thank you, Ilya. Omar, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is about Hussam's comment about the Ramadan holidays. I think on July, 5th of July, the Ramadan will end, and it's going to be the Eid holidays for 3 days. And that might cause some absentees, possibly. So if it could be moved behind the Eid, would be good.
Thank you. I did see some support for moving it with heads nodding around the room, but we'll finalize this later. Thank you. Marilyn, you were next.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Marilyn Cade speaking. I just wanted to make an informative, informational comment about the national and regional, the informal national and regional IGF coordinators meeting that took place at lunch today, and to kind of position a request to other MAG members about some of the views that were expressed by the those who are very directly and heavily involved in the national and regional IGFs. So one of them, and I will say, I want to make a comment. There has always been a substantive session at each of the IGFs. But last year, the approach to organizing it was very different. I was invited by Yanis Karklins, the MAG chair, to serve as the substantive coordinator. We put together a planning group. We did a survey. A group of the coordinators planned the substantive session. There are people here who were actively involved in it. It ended up with concrete recommendations and proposals for improvements, which are publicly available and were reported on. The coordinators called for a similar session that they would self-organize. So I just want to park that as something that I think we all want to be aware of, because we keep talking about bottom-up, and there's probably nothing more bottom-up than the fact that the coordinators are so directly engaged. But secondly, historically, there have been other ways that I believe it was Sharm el-Sheikh, there were 30-minute time slots set aside in a meeting room where any of the national or regional sessions, I remember there were many fewer then, could do, in essence, a very short brief on what they were doing as a way to build visibility. I'm not trying to in any way dictate. I just want to report on some of the ideas that the broad group, and it is a very broad group, is talking about themselves. But I want to mention an area of sensitivity for us to be aware of. Last year,
we identified as the MAG connecting the next billion as a priority intersessional working issue. And Cheryl, I think, actually was very instrumental in catalyzing and working with other MAG members to get that concept identified. We made a voluntary call to comment from the national and regional IGFs, and a very significant number of them took that up. Because of our timing, I ask us to keep in mind that if we are going to be looking to the national and regional IGFs to perhaps conduct a special consistent session or to provide comments, that we should keep in mind that they are going to need to have flexibility because of the timing of their event on how they then participate in that intersessional work. Secondly, they did a survey of their own, and they have a list of topics that I think it would be important for us to respectfully listen to about some of the ideas and interests that they have.
Thank you, Marilyn. And there is never a good time to say this, but if I could ask everybody to make their comments quite brief, we could get more speakers in as well. Juan, you have the floor next.
Thank you, Lynn. Three things. Two of the things, well, first the new one. I checked at least last week in the website that the description of the formats for the workshops was not available anymore. I think that it's important to have that description, because it helps the groups that are proposing the workshops to have that. And even I heard some suggestion that maybe that could be even more streamlined, because I think it was 7 modalities. Maybe it could be reduced, but it doesn't matter. But it has to be an explanation in order to guide. That's one thing. The other two things, I am totally in agreement with Avri that, for instance, the number of workshops, it has to be, it should not be arbitrarily lowered. It depends on the facilities and the times that we have. Of course, if we have infinite facility, we won't have infinite workshop. We could have the number that we had last year. Maybe it could be the maximum, but not push it down, because you have to put ourselves in the place of the people that want to have their workshops, and you know, to deny a workshop, it's always traumatic for the people. And finally, the things about the themes. What Avri said is actually true. I think themes, it's something that has to be what is really of interest right now. We can discuss that ourselves, because we live in this world and we know more or less what is trending in this, and that could be the topic. But another way will be to extract it from the proposals of the workshop themselves, or maybe some sort of survey or something like that, in order to be bottom up. In this sense, I will tell you a little anecdote of a very important architect in Cuba. He designed a campus, you know, that it has different buildings with, you know, that connect through grass. And he was thinking where to put the paths, to pave the paths, because, you know, but sometimes he didn't realize to pave the path this way and people walk some other way, and, you know, and they kill the grass. So what he did is that for the first month, he didn't make any path. So after he found the way that people walk, then he paved the path. I think that, well, it's sorry that the Spanish colleague is not here, because that's what the poet said. Caminante no hay camino. Se hace camino al andar. Well, everybody understands that. You don't have a path, you make paths as you walk. So that's my recommendation.
That's a great anecdote. Thank you. We have just 3 more speakers. I will ask them to brief, and then we are going to the Mexican presentation, because flags still keep going up. So we have Izumi, then Murad, and Cheryl.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First, to touch upon the theme, since it was mentioned by Juan. So I also like I agree with both the points that you need some guidance to the new people who are proposing workshop on what would be the kind of topics that they should cover. At the same time, make this workshop submission to be bottom up based on what people are willing to propose. So I like Virat's idea on giving reference to the past sub-themes that were covered so that people would have rough idea on what were the topics that were covered in the past. But leave it for people to propose and tag later. And if there are any themes that we actually find is substantial, which were not covered in our past workshops, maybe we can add that as a theme. That's just one thought as a way to balance the feedback from both sides. And I really want to support the idea of continuing the webinars and the idea of FAQ suggested. And as a additional suggestion on how we organize the webinar, maybe we can really reach out to national and regional IGFs as well, so that they would know and can help us reach out. And I think it will, if in the webinar we can cover the concept of this year's IGF, not just on the details of submitting the workshop, that might give the national and regional IGFs on how they actually can plan their meeting. For example, if this is a common horizontal theme like we did last year, then they can actually add that as a topic for discussions in their local IGF. So some thoughts. Thanks.
So I think we've heard a number of times there's a lot of support for webinars and other supporting activities. If I could ask people to refrain from kind of commenting on that and perhaps put some additional newer ideas forward, again, that would just help us to move forward. Murad.
Thank you. On sub-themes, I think that it was rightly mentioned by some submissions made prior to our meeting. We should avoid, as a group, to replicate what has been done in the past, in the sense that some themes have been overwhelmingly discussed, where others have been less or even never discussed. I think that a mapping of all themes of previous IGF meetings will be extremely helpful for us. The objective is to avoid redundancy and giving the impression to the broader community that we are lacking imagination in terms of designing the agenda of the IGF, and thus having the risk to make it less attractive in the future. Another issue I forgot to mention before is related to workshops criteria and guidelines. I think that we need to, that a good work was done in the last 2 years, and thus there is need to set once for all definitive criteria and guidelines that are not rediscussed each year. Finally, I am of the view that we need to reduce number of workshops as mentioned by some previous speakers. Thank you.
Thank you, Morhan. Cheryl. You have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I promise this will be 30 seconds if I can. I think this has been a really thoughtful discussion, and I heard a lot of support on both sides under sub-themes for a little bit of guidance and then some freedom, and I actually agree with both. I was thinking maybe to kind of strike a balance, we could list a few themes and then just leave open kind of an other box, the box I usually always have to check on forms and things. So if people have any other sub-theme they want to suggest, they can go ahead, more experienced people who can do that, and then for folks who just aren't sure or would be more comfortable checking something, they have that option too. Thanks.
So we'll come back to that discussion afterwards. I'd like to move to Victor now, and then those people that were still in the queue, Mike, Flavio, and Sala, will open the queue back up. And thank you, Flavio, for being so accepting. Michael, thank you, too. He's like...
Thank you, Madam Chair. I actually passed a couple of slides to our technical support, so I'm going to be showing you a couple of slides. I don't think they really depict, the whole venue, yet it can guide the conversation as to what type of event we want to have and what type of sessions we want to host. Also, we've been using this layout to get already some quotes for infrastructure and some production companies that that can help us build on top of the venue itself. The first one is really enlisting. Thank you. It's enlisting the bigger spaces that we have available. Everything from the main venue, the bigger one for inaugural speech and the closure. We can actually have a layout of around 1,000 to 3,000 people. It depends what we want to do with it. It's an open space. We can close it. Of course, in November, December, it's lower chances of rain. I would love if we can actually have an open, skies, but in Mexico, you never know. So it can be one of those crazy days that there's monsoon happening for half an hour and it will completely destroy the venue. But the bigger one, which it can host 1,500, 2,000 people, I think that'll be comfortable enough. And then we have a couple ones that are smaller for the main sessions. We still have to build around them. So there are, some of them are patios, some of them are actually closed spaces. And then we have what's the Tulsa Chapel. It has some frescoes inside. I don't know if you remember the picture that we have on one of the previous slides, the photograph, we took it just last week. We can build certain things on top of it, and we've already been given the type of events that can be hosted there, but we cannot change dramatically the chapel itself. It can host around 150 up to 300 people. There's also a movie theater. 160 people can be hosted there. Mainly, those are the bigger spaces. From there, we start to go down into kind of the smaller working group sessions or workshops, workshop groups, and our surrounding, what's the area of the museum itself, and also the school. We have an arts school on the back side of the institute, of the cultural institute. Can you go into the slide that I just sent you?
Sorry, I did not receive.
Did you get that? You didn't get the email?
No. Right now, yes. Sorry, one moment, and I put it. Please.
Okay. Could you help me out, Julian? But by capturing a couple of comments, well, some of the comments that you mentioned, I think it's on us to really put forward the type of environment that we want to create. I think today we can actually make it more so engaging. There's new formats, newer formats. Everything from the TED Talks, which we're all familiar with, kind of smaller venues, simpler talks, shorter conversations, bigger screens, and so on, which I think can be accommodated in some of the smaller spots, the 300 to 200, two to 300 people. Also, Virat mentioned the on-panel sessions. I've seen it executed in a way that it may sound funny, but on a kind of speed dating type format, which then everyone has an opportunity to ask the questions in a kind of smaller spaces in round tables, and then it can be actually very, very active, very engaging. I do believe part of the challenge would be to truly engage remote participation and to bridge the physical into the kind of the virtual worlds of all the people who will be connected and all the countries who will be connected who will not have the opportunity to join us in Mexico. For those, what we are proposing, and I put this on the discussion table, is to really work around everything from simple online polls that we can bring forward and give feedback and serve as feedback to even the speakers or the panels, in more of a real-time manner. So the way that we've executed that in previous events is, even when we're doing webcasting, we do have specific and specialized teams listening to whatever is happening on the forum and putting that forward in the online webcast. So not only the transcript itself, but also references, additional information, the conversation that can actually happen online, and feed that into the webcast itself. On our opinion, it has actually fueled a lot of the conversations to have that transcribed and the conversation depicted in real time as part of the main of the webcast itself. We're heavy social media users in Mexico. I think that's a commonplace in the world right now. But of course, we understand that the younger generation, it's basically where they live and spend a lot of their time. They'll be expecting that we will have a very heavy, strategy towards social media. We understand, we need to assess how to make the best use of, you know, Facebook, make the best use of Twitter, and also newer tools, for example, Periscope, that are actually quite strong today in terms of video casting and so on. On my opinion, we could build certain incentives or ask the speakers and certain panels to actually, via Periscope, share some of their insights and so on. We tried those on several occasions in Mexico, and we've actually got a lot of attention and a lot of engagement. Is it possible to go inside some of the rooms? And I'll be asking Yolanda to help me guide part of this discussion and to share you some of the spaces. This was one of the proposals that so far has been changed a little bit around how to make the best use of the spaces. I'm not sure whether you can actually go in or zoom in into the.
It's not possible at the moment, sorry, because it's hooked.
¿Quieres tomarla? Is it possible, Madam Chair, to have Yolanda?
We can definitely share the first approximation to meeting the requirements. This is basically based on what we received from the Secretariat as minimum requirements to have the conference. So what we did during the planning mission is to actually go around the entire venue and review all the spaces. And the next steps will be to actually refine this first proposal in order to make sure that we meet all requirements. So far we can guarantee that we're going to have a conference hall that can host up to 2,500 people. We can guarantee 12 workshop rooms. We can also guarantee between 8 to 10 bilateral areas, and all office requires, including media space. And that's just considering the school area within the institute. We can also use the exposition rooms, which are actually very well maintained and with air conditioning. So that is going to be analyzed as we move forward to analyzing each requirement in a more specific manner. But so far, this is the first assessment. It may change according to the final requirements in terms of the agenda and the workshops and the number of sessions. But because of the facility and the venue, we definitely can expand and use more rooms if necessary, because we have the entire venue given to us for the event. So I think is an interesting venue in terms of meeting the requirements that the MAC sets for the agenda. And as soon as we have a narrow scope on the sessions and the schedules and the type of activities that is expected to have during the conference, we could definitely narrow down to a more specific room number or bilateral meeting spaces, since we have the opportunity to expand if necessary.
Thank you. And maybe I'll just ask Chengatai at this point to jump in and ask him if there's anything he wants to help translate in terms of the sorts of questions the MAG usually has with respect to the room's number and size. I mean, is there anything additional that you understand about the venue that you would communicate?
Yes. So sorry. Just for our consideration, when we're talking about types of room configurations, I think we'll be a little bit limited to basically classroom size, or we have to come with some other types of configuration. But hollow square configuration, I don't think we can do in this venue item. But that doesn't mean that, you know, we can't become inventive and use the patios as meeting points as well, which would be quite interesting, especially since it is December and most people will be coming from very cold climates, so would like to be outside in the sun. Yes, and the workshop rooms, from what I guesstimated, it'll be like 60, 80 to 120. 60. 80 to 120 people fitting in the workshop rooms.
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah. Yes. Mm. That's about it, yeah.
So they'll hold from 60 to 120, or some are at 60 and some are at 120?
Some are at 60. So to err on the side of caution, I would say, you know, 60, 80, maybe 100.
Yes.
Yeah. And but then again, I do encourage everybody just to look at it, and we can do stuff with that room. You don't have to just stay at theater setting, for example. We can do other stuff with the space that is available.
So I'm going to give a comment that may not be well, I'm trying to structure in my head, but so I attended the World Economic Forum in Dalian in China just this past October, November, and if you were like 2 minutes late into any session, you would not get in. And it was very frustrating for a lot of people. So it was structured in a way that that really there were like 80 people to 100 people in every session, and there were like 200 people interested in going into those. So of course, you know, there was a demand problem there. Yet, one of the things that they did well, you know, besides a lot of things, was that they actually put a room so that we could actually jump in, connect via actually a mobile app, listen to the webcast, and then of course not being physically present in the room, but you could actually look for any space available, sit down, and then just connect via webcast, either on big screens or even on the phone or an iPad or whatever. What I'm trying to say is, I think we can find ways to make a full experience, even though you're not in the room. There may be people who actually don't want to be in the room, that, you know, either they're not in the venue itself, but we can present for some opportunities for people who want to actually jump from room to room virtually as well, right?
So if there's nothing more at this point in time, I would go back to the three we had in the queue, and there have been a few more requests for the queue, and then obviously you'll be able to help guide us here as the questions come up. So Mike, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chairman. Thanks for getting back to this topic of how to provide some sense of what the IGF is about through themes and sub-themes. I think Avery really got to the core of the question. It's how can we give some guidance without being really top-down? I think in the past we've done that pretty well. Jovan mentioned the idea that maybe we need to allocate parts of the program for different types of sessions. I would argue that that would be far too top down, because we might not have quality sessions to fill those designated slots. But I do think we have to have at least themes. They're not paths, they're really fences. They're the boundaries that we show people so that they know whether a topic they're thinking of submitting is anywhere close to the kind of topic that would be accepted by the group. Juan's point is really good. At the University of Puget Sound, where I grew up, they also designed their sidewalks by letting people walk. But they do have fences around the campus, so people know where the campus is. And that's what the themes do. The themes tell people, yes, this is a good place for me to submit. If we don't have themes at all, we're going to get 50 or more proposals from people who are just completely off target. And then we're going to have 50 people mad because they weren't told that they were off target ahead of time. So I'd strongly urge that we at least have the high-level themes and provide that. I'd also like to say that if we allowed people to post their proposals online before the deadline, that would also provide some sense of what this conference is about, and I think in the end lead to higher quality proposals. I do that for my classes. All the homework is posted on our class blog so that all the classmates can see it, and that provides a push for everybody to do a particularly good proposal.
Thank you, Michael. Flavio, you have the floor.
Thank you, Lynn. I would also like to voice my support to the bottom-up approach as already proposed by many MAG members. I think that we will hardly arrive at a decision on sub-themes during this MAG meeting here. It will be very hard to arrive at a decision. Virat, for instance, proposed the four sub-themes of IGF 2006. They are really overarching, but they do not capture all the richness of the relevant issues we have today, 10 years later. So I think that in a bottom-up approach, the proposers should tag their proposals with the sub-themes they suggest themselves, up to three tags, for instance, for each proposal, so that after we have the proposals, we can easily cluster the workshops, identifying that we can give guidance, for instance, with this kind of description of list of all overarching themes and sub-themes of all 10 past editions of IGF, just as a suggestion, but which does not exclude any other sub-theme that the proposers may want to add. So then they just give the tags. And this may help us to identify and cluster the workshops afterwards. There is one point in the agenda, Lynn, I don't know if we will arrive at that today or tomorrow, which is the definition of the main theme. This is on the agenda. If we really, yeah, the overarching theme. If we really will discuss this overarching theme, then this would be a guidance in the call for workshop proposals, and then the proposers should write at least one paragraph in their proposals stating how this proposal fits into the overarching theme. And so this would give some focus to the proposals, and I think we could combine the two ideas. Having the main overarching theme, having a bottom-up approach, and having the tags to help us cluster the sub-themes.
Thank you, Flavio. And it is key that we actually do get to the main theme before the end of the day tomorrow. Sala, you have the floor. And again, if we could all be as brief as we could in our comments, there's quite a queue building.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'd like, Sala, for the record, I'd like to thank Flavio for what he just circulated on the MEG list. Because of that, I would like to withdraw my earlier comments and say that, yes, we can finalize the theme by tomorrow. And having said that, I'm going to, because of time limitations, I'm going to send the portion of the survey that's relevant to the theme discussion, and I'll just stop there. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Excellent. Thank you, Sala. Look forward to getting that. Marilyn, you are next, and then we have Virat and online participants. Marilyn withdrew. Virat?
Yeah, I'm just going to quickly respond to some clarifications the points were raised so that we can try and consolidate the points that we are at. First, on the point of formats that was raised, by the way, last year we did have, not only did we have formats, we had scores for formats. So when that thing comes up, you will see in the criteria for rating, there is panel, roundtable, flash discussions, debates, breakout discussions, bird of the feather, and others. Not only is there was there a score that was a higher score that was recommended by the working group last year for innovative sessions, but in fact the panels that we disliked, by and large, at least the MAG last year disliked, which is the most popular piece that the workshop wants, so organizers want. So there's a contradiction there in terms. There was an extra barrier created. So we do have a format. Not only when you see the next shots, you'll see options for formats, but in fact there is scores for formats and innovative formats. With regards to themes, I just want to make a quick point because that's been discussed a lot. We can go either ways. We can have broad themes. I've sent something to Chengatai, it's just sort of circulated, but I think what Flavio has out there. Or we could do bottom-up. But if we do bottom-up, which is what has been recommended now by Avery, Liesl, and Flavio, then we need to know that you cannot do scoring on themes. Because still last year, we have scored on themes. Like, how close are you to the theme? Are you matching the theme under which you're submitting this? So there's an actual score that is allocated for coming to the theme. If you don't have that, I just want to say it's a perfect approach, but then it is a bit of a nightmare as well on scoring, because then it's 240 proposals with many themes, which then becomes your responsibility to try and cluster them together. Remember, the agenda that appears on the program for IGF has color schemes to indicate your area of interest, which flows from the themes. So if you're building it bottom upwards, which is a fantastic idea, there is extra time required and a lot of effort required, and you can't score people on being on a new theme. So that will change our evaluation process. On the point, just on the point of the Jack raised and Andrea raised about extra time, 8 weeks on one side and 4 weeks on one side, here is what we could do if, because I want to go back to the timetable one, because we need to close that part. We must try and close the timetable at least. If you were to expand, instead of 11 days, let's say 21 days and not 30 days for evaluation, which is what Jack was asking, we need more time, and we were to take about 5 or 6 days back from the extra time given to the secretariat and add a week to the extension, we could then shift the meeting to 13th, 14th, and 15th. But if you go anywhere beyond that, then we're in the middle of July, and then everything starts sort of into holiday season. So the only other way we can do this by giving extra time that we require, but if we add the extra 2 weeks that Andrea's requested, then we move into August. So if you want to give some more time, we'll have to do 1 week extra and take some time back from the secretariat, which has already been sort of cushioned was there. And we'll have to, and people can look at their calendars and tell us if 13th, 14th, and 15th of July work better. That's one way to resolve this problem. The last thing I want to say in terms of the space allocation, the highest number of visitors we've had on site is 2,400 in Istanbul. On an average, at any given point in time, never more than 1,200 people are on site, maximum 1,300 people on site. Which means if you have, and the way we've, I'm just giving ideas so that we know how these formats are done. If you have 10 workshop and one main session running parallelly, we require about 12 rooms. So the fact that you have 12 rooms is perfect. And that will accommodate on a given that out of 1,200, 200 in the cafeteria and some in the toilet, you'll have about. Well, I just want to get
those are called bylaws.
Yeah. So I just want to be clear about. So what you need is about 12 rooms, and you have and that is what you require. That's been our requirement. We run on an average 10 parallel sessions, and by the way, that accommodates in turn. 100 up to 100 workshops and about 14 or 15 or up to 20 other things like the other parallel sessions we have. So it roughly is similar to what we've done in the past. I just want, maybe I'm off by a little, but I think that's where.
That's great. I just had another thought. Also, it's a great place to have, we wanted like a speaker's corner. It's a great place to have
a speaker's corner
as well. So, and it's great for networking. So,
I'm limiting my comment to the rooms required. If you run 10 parallel workshops, which includes other types of sessions and a main session, 12 would actually make perfect sense with the capacity that's been demonstrated. I think those are the points I wanted to address. That's it. Thank you.
Okay. Also about the themes, there was a comment about the themes. One of the ideas was that we set the main theme, and the main theme can be in line with the SDGs or the 2030 agenda, and we can still keep the scoring, how closely the workshops align to that theme. But then, of course, under that theme, there can be sub-themes can be evolved out of those. So we have the main theme, but we decide the sub-themes after the workshops have come out.
I'm saying we can do that, just that you can't score on that. I mean, then you can just score on the linkage to the main theme. But in the last years, we have always scored on the proximity to the sub-themes. So you'll have to change the scoring.
We just change it to the main theme.
Well, everybody will justify linking it to the main theme. Main themes are very broad. It's all I'm saying is that score goes off. And that's fine, and it can be done. And it's a nightmare for us to bring it together and then cluster them, because you remember, when you do the program, there are color coordinations of saying access are in all blues, and diversity is in all green, or privacy is in all. That's how your program appears on the website, right? So now we'll have to make this the other way around. That's all I'm suggesting. Yeah.
So Flavio,
just a small comment. I have the evaluation form here in front of me. There is no really scoring regarding the sub theme. There is scores for relevance of topic to internet governance, a specificity in the problem, question, challenge to be addressed, and things like that. But it's not really a score if you see the form, the evaluation form. There is no really direct scoring regarding the sub theme. It's in the evaluation form, yeah.
Thank you, Flavio. And I think maybe we can just set this aside just for a moment. I'm going to go to the online participants, but when I come back, Virat, and I think I have a question for you, Anya, first. At some point, can you tell me how many MAG members are actually online? And Virat, if you could just get the 4 or 5 key dates out clearly, sort of when the call would go out, if we're allowing 7 weeks for, because obviously the table that we have now doesn't work. I'd like
so
to just get
reworked.
A clear picture okay. In front of everybody. And if we can close on that today, and there are enough folks online to make me feel comfortable that they've been able to have a look at it as well, then we'll see if we can close. Anya, there were some online participants.
Thank you. Yes, Sylvia, you have the floor now.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Chair. Can you hear me well?
We can hear you.
Thank you. My name is Sylvia Monson de Villard. I'm a MAG member. I'm with the Vice President that is the Worldwide IT Industry Alliances, and I'm also the Senior Director of ALETI, the Ibero-American ICT Industry Federation. I'm also ILAC Vice President of the IT Industry Task Force, and if you don't know, ILAC is the research process of Latin America under ECLAC UN Secretariat, where Mexico chose the president. And they are doing a really tremendous job. I agree with the proposal to reduce the number of workshops and merge activities. Some workshops of last year didn't have more than 5 or 10 participants, even they were of very good quality. Intersessionals and interventionals seems to be a good idea as well. teachers' corners is also a very good idea. On the other hand, no team will be discussed tomorrow, and last year's results can help us to see the past, as Juan Fernandez mentioned. On the other hand, in order to save the program of this year, I would like to raise the importance of the internet-driven economy to business development, jobs creation, social inclusion, and open data. Therefore, I propose you, MAG members, to dedicate space to have capacity-building sessions about key opportunities, challenges, best practices, to identify policies and practices to open opportunities for economical and social development. Also to consider the importance of SMEs within the digital ecosystems and the need for the MAG to work together to focus on increasing the participation of all kinds of stakeholders from developing countries. Also, just let you know that it's not a very easy task to gain the attention of small businesses participants, and that we need to increase their participation. And last, I would like to congratulate the organizers for the good quality of the meeting and all MAC members. This concludes my presentation.
Thank you, Sylvia.
Thank you, Sylvia. Currently, we have 10 MAG members online.
10 members online, which is excellent. I mean, would obviously be much better for you and us if we were all in the same room, but really appreciate everybody hanging in there. I think Verit's gone out to rework the timetable so we can all get a clear idea of where we are. I did think it was actually coming together reasonably well in terms of the key components, which is the amount of time the workshop proposals would have time to submit their proposals. I think we were coming to agreement on a reasonable time for the MAG to do their evaluation, and it feels like we've come to a reasonable time period for the physical meeting as well. I would certainly, and I can see that through the body language in the room. For those online participants, I'm sorry, I can't see your body language. But we'll have Vera come back and put a clear timetable up, and we'll take one more comment on that. I'm also, I think, hearing that with respect to the venue and the number and size of the workshop rooms and spaces that are available to us, that there's a fairly good match between that availability and the number of workshops we'd expect to have over the period of time. Is that a fair statement as well? There's two things we need to move forward on next. One is, of course, the discussion on themes and sub-themes. The other one is the workshop components, which is both the sorts of formats we might be looking for or encouraging, and then, of course, the supporting documents with respect to workshop criteria and guideline. I'm looking at the time. I actually would like to take sort of a half hour or so, see if we can get make some progress on the main theme. When Vera comes back, we'll look at the timeline. And then I think in a quick sort of 20 minutes at the end, if we look at those workshop documents and proposals that are out, either I think we're going to say they're good and they work well, or we may want to ask a small group of people to go away, look at those, and then get something back out to the MAG for tomorrow morning's meeting. As I said, I think those proposals were actually quite complete, and much of the work is done. I think it's more a matter of, is there anything that we learned over the last year that should be reflected or should be updated? So I'm hoping we can get really close to closing that out by tomorrow morning as well, which would then allow us to come back tomorrow, spend some more time on the main theme and the sub-themes. Is that, and somebody should also tell me if I'm forgetting any major pieces here. Marilyn, you have the floor.
Thank you, Marilyn Cade speaking. I just have a quick question, and perhaps I missed this discussion, but the, and I'm so sorry,
the area where we have the small booths and we have sometimes a speakers, et cetera, did we talk about where that would be and how much space we have for it? And the reason I ask is that if we were to do something like in Hyderabad, we had a situation, we had a space that was sort of artificially built with a what looked like a false wall behind it and a curtain and three chairs in front of a the wall and 15 to 20 seats that people could schedule for 20 minute, 30 minute, they weren't called TED Talks, but and it, that really provided, we did something, some of the pavilions did something like that during Tunis as well. So if the space were large enough in where we're going to put the, I don't want to call it the exhibits.
We call it the IGF Village.
Thank you. Where we're putting the IGF Village. And we could know that before we start thinking about alternate approaches. I think that would be helpful.
The space is there. There's no worry about that. There's going to be enough space for the IGF Village, and there's going to be enough space for the Speaker's Corner. I don't think we should worry about exactly where it is, but there is enough space for that.
Thank you. Omar, you have the floor, and then Cheryl.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I wanted to propose with regards to the themes and sub-themes. If the themes can be identified, a list of themes and then sub-themes by the MAG, and it's available to the workshop proposers, but at the same time, if we can give them an option to suggest another sub-theme, you know, or maybe main theme, but since they're broader topics, we might not need to give them an option with the main themes, but with the sub-themes, because you know, technology is evolving and there might be some other topics people would suggest as sub-themes. So a list of themes and then with an option of adding or proposing another sub-theme.
Thank you, Omar. Cheryl, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to clarify with respect to what you said, what we'd focus on tomorrow as well. Will we still budget time for the intersessional discussion and main session? Okay, just wanted to double check. Thanks.
So I was shaking my head yes, which doesn't do anything for those people that are participating online or those of you that are looking at your computers. At this point, if we wanted to start entertaining a discussion on main themes, we could get, I've exhausted the queue at the moment. We could kick that discussion off, and again, I think probably put sort of 25, 30 minutes to it, which ought to be enough to get us some part of the way there. So with that, the floor is open. Anya?
There is an intervention from an online participant, Peter Dengen-Trush.
Yes, Madam Chair, I'm not quite sure if now is the right time, but I wanted to pick up on a point I think raised by Ginger Park yesterday, and that is with a 10-year framework ahead of us, we might be able to avoid one of the problems of previous, or of all of the mags, which is this sort of cycling exercise. We don't have to have the same things turn up or just miss out when we run the same program or the same thing year after year. It's always very hard to plan a couple of years out, but if we could plan for more years, we could make themes that are available this year and make it clear now that a different set of themes will be available in future years, and that way we can concentrate on this particular MAG instead of trying to have to cater for everyone. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Peter. I mean, I think that's an excellent suggestion, and I think, you know, it's trying to make a trade-off between that and, of course, making enough progress on this. There were, at a couple of different points yesterday, the point mooted that said, given the, I think, enthusiasm in this room for tying some portion of what we do here through the SDGs and the fact that there are 17 SDGs, that one sort of simple road through this might be to agree that this year we're going to focus on a couple of specific SDG goals. And, you know, I'm not sure in this meeting we need to schedule out the next, but if there was a commitment that over the next 3-4 years, we would actually address some number of the SDGs. And I think that's, maybe a reasonable way to move forward. So I'll put that there. Maybe this is a good time to talk a little bit about SDGs and what we might actually see in terms of their linkage to IGF for a moment. So I have Elizabeth, and then I have Marilyn in the queue, and I have Wisdom. I love saying that.
Thank you, Chair. So just on that point you've just raised, I think there is a solid interest in tying what we do to the SDGs. A suggestion that came in through came into me that I think has merit for us to consider, and I've heard the host country use the buzzwords a couple of times around the digital divides, was the theme of bridging the digital divides. And this could be something that focuses on the different divides, not the typical single focus on that, but perhaps looking at issues like gender, youth, accessibility, language literacy, skills, contents, and the associated sustainable development goals that might link under that broader topic. So I put that out there in response to your question.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Marilyn, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I wanted to take the floor, if Marilyn Cade speaking, I wanted to take the floor to make a general proposal about how we might address the SDGs, referring back to comments made by Virat Bhataia yesterday, and referencing the WSIS Plus 10 main session that I was heavily involved in, as well as Ambassador Fonseca, yourself, Chief Leah, yes, in organizing it. And I guess rather than thinking that we would arbitrarily pick a couple of the 17 SDGs, I would propose a consideration of a slightly different approach. And that is to consider organizing, and I would love to collaborate in helping to do that, helping to organize a session similar to the WSIS Plus 10 session that we held. It was both highly informational to parties that weren't familiar with what WSIS Plus 10 was. It helped to link WSIS Plus 10 directly to the Internet Governance Forum and other Internet governance issues. And it was highly interactive, if you will remember, Madam Chair, as you and Ambassador Fonseca were assigned the whip and chair approach of no more than 2 minutes per speaker. We could address the, and we could decide in the end if we do address all of the 17 goals, but I think if we parked that as an idea, and maybe I know that McCain is particularly interested in this, some others are, maybe we could do a little offline work and come back with a rough design. If there was broad MAG support for that, the benefit to that would be we would actually be able to then make a call to action to the national and regional IGFs. A, we know this session is going to take place on day one at X time. B, if you participate, if your national or regional IGF decides to address this issue, you can plan ahead. So it would help us, and it would only take up one of the main sessions.
I think that's an interesting suggestion. Thank you. Wisdom, you have the floor.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. I've been listening and then following, but I have some few things to read here. I'm going to make a reference. In reference to the reaffirmation resolution 70, one of the United Nations, entitled Transforming Our World, the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, in which it adopted a comprehensive, far-reaching, and people-centered set of universal and transformative sustainable development goals and targets. Now, it commitment to working tirelessly for the full implementation of the agenda by 2030. Its recognition that eradicating poverty in all its forms and dimensions, including extreme poverty, is the greatest global challenge and an indispensable requirement for sustainable development. Now, its commitment to achieving sustainable development in its three dimensions, economic, social, and then environmental. Now, in a balanced and integrated manner, and to building upon the achievements of the Millennium Development Goals and seeking to address their unfinished business. And then in paragraph 55 of the Tunis Agenda states that in this regard, recognize that the existing arrangements have worked effectively to make the internet the highly robust, dynamic, and geographically diverse medium that it is today, with the private sector taking the lead in day-to-day operations and with innovation and the creation of value at the edges. Now, however, almost 4 billion people representing approximately two-thirds of the people residing in developing countries remain offline. Okay, in recognition to that, there is a need to promote greater participation and engagement in the internet governance discussions of government, the private sector, civil society, international organizations, the technical and academic communities, and all other relevant stakeholders from developing countries. Now, particularly African countries, least developed countries, landlocked developing countries, and small island developing states, and middle-income countries, as well as countries in situation of conflict, post-conflict countries, and countries affected by natural disaster. We call for strengthened, stable, transparent, and voluntary funding mechanism to this end. Now, I am on the view that looking at this, the import of the team should come from within this, a team that will attract a larger population of people that will come to the conference. Now, if governments will come to this conference, it will depend on the team that we are putting out there. Now, the team that we are going to put out there should actually revolve around these sustainable development goals. And then the sub-team should connect with it. Example of that is could be, let me say, open data. Now, governments are looking at using open data to create jobs. And then we should see all this that we are going to solve a problem. The problem that we are going to solve is what, eradicating poverty from these developing countries. So the people who are going to submit proposal should be solving a problem. That is, I think that is what we should be looking at. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Wisdom. Makan, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yes, I think that the suggestion by Marilyn is quite appropriate. And at the Global IGF, as the SDGs are not that so many, I believe that we could tackle them. And in the regional and national IGF, then countries may choose which one is they want to tackle this year and the next year and so on. And in this, the connection of tackling the SDGs also, the partnership for measuring ICT for development is working on each SDG and has put in place some measurables on how to achieve them. On the African side, as I indicated earlier, we will be mainly focusing on SDG 5, achieving gender equality and empowering all women and girls. Thank you.
Thank you, Makan. I have Juan in the queue. Juan, you have the floor.
Yeah. I'm sorry that maybe I'm a little bit pessimist. I think that we don't have the time to get into this discussion of what themes we prefer, we that are here. This could be an endless discussion, and I'm sure that all the proposals will have a lot of merit. I'm going to make the proposal. The 17, this Sustainable Development Goal, is really a big issue. It's really the hope for at least what the international community agreed as the way. Maybe it's not perfect, but it's the way that it's been agreed to try to make this world a better one. And as you say, it's very wide, 17. So what do I propose? To in the call for workshops, put to say that this year IGF is to support with this technology the Sustainable Development Goals, and let them make proposals, and then we maybe of some of the Sustainable Development Goals, like for instance, I don't know, life below water. Maybe we don't get any proposal there, so that will not be there. And maybe there's some other proposals that for us is very difficult to fit here, because I want to remind my colleagues here that when this is Internet Governance Forum, it's not ICT for development. But what is that, as the chairman pointed out last time, when the working group of Internet Governance was trying to define Internet governance, there was two views. The narrow view, in which it's only technical aspects of the functioning of the Internet, or what it was considered the wide aspect, in which all this developmental part, human rights, gender, and all that, it's part of Internet governance. So, and that is why a lot of this SDG can fit there. The gender is there, the inequality, many of the human rights can go there, and all that. And I think that will cut the discussion short. And as I was telling before, maybe we will have some hard time where to fit. For instance, if there's some workshop on YANA transition, I don't know where to put it, but maybe in industry, innovation, and infrastructure. Maybe that is in that Sustainable Development Goal we can put it. Maybe it's a bit artificial to put it there. But at least this gives us an agreed set of themes that maybe if I were doing, I could put some that are not here. But at least it's the one that is agreed. And we will cut all the discussion and move with this.
Thank you, Juan. Liesl, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. On the discussion of the main theme, I mean, I still, you know, sort of evolving the conversation about the sub-themes and whether or not we need to finalize them here. There may be a hybrid approach, as we've heard discussed, between at least giving some indication of the themes that have been around the IGF in a general way and having another box. I kind of like that idea. So I think there may be a hybrid to the bottom-up and existing sort of themes for the sub-themes that we've had. So I value the discussion that we've been having here. Moving to the main theme, I'm finding myself agreeing with my distinguished colleague from Cuba that this is the Internet Governance Forum. And while the SDGs is very important and the agenda for 2030 is priority program for many of us, and there's certainly room and call for stakeholder discussions on those issues, I hesitate to think of it as a main theme for the IGF at this stage, perhaps. I think that there is a way, though, if we want to use the tagging mechanism or a question in the workshop proposal form for how does this proposal or this issue that you want to discuss contribute to the SDGs, I'd feel more comfortable with an integrated approach to that kind of lower level integrated approach to tracking how these things might contribute to the SDGs, keeping in mind though that this is the IGF and we have our own sort of topics to discuss that may have some, that likely have important contributions to SDGs, but it's its own forum as well and has timely topics to talk about each year. So I would hate to lose that in sight of this agenda that we have for 2030 right now out of the gate in the first IGF in the new mandate. So I just put that out there for additional consideration. Thank you. Oh, and just to add that, to add to the consideration of main themes, the U.S. did put forward a suggestion in our submission to the Taking Stock and Looking Forward call for input. And our theme that we put forward is for consideration is fostering knowledge, forging connections, which we thought would have a very broad-based applicability to many of the things that we discuss in the IGF and the topics that can be raised each year. So just put that out there for thought, food for thought as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Liesl. Let me actually just check here for a moment, and then Michael, I have you in the queue. We need to make sure we're not confusing main sessions with main theme, right? So, I mean, just for those that are new, I know Virat actually has a chart, but I think it's simple enough that we can describe it. There are 4 days in the IGF, not counting day zero. Typically, that's left 8 slots of 3 hours each for main sessions. Two of those are taken up with the opening ceremony and the closing ceremonies. Those remaining 6 slots, we can of course keep as 3-hour slots, which allow you to do much more substantive things, perhaps the SDG WSIS-like process we did, an SDG process following the WSIS-like process we did at the last one. You can, of course, split them up into 2 sessions. There's lots to do. It's just that we've typically reserved those 3-hour blocks. Those are meant to be fairly substantive topics. And there's quite a small list, I think, that people would probably already agree. I think SDGs is one that people would probably say is a reasonable topic. I don't think I heard people say the main theme for the IGF ought to be SDGs. So I want to a quick kind of comment in terms of am I reading that right or not? And Liesl's looking for the floor again, but then there's Mike Flavio Sala Juan. Liesl, you have the floor.
Thank you. I'm well aware of the main theme, main session distinction. So thank you for pointing that out, because I think that is important, and maybe people were using the wrong terminology with regard to what they were saying, but certainly referred to SDGs as a main theme, so I just wanted to clarify for my purposes, main sessions is another matter. Thank you.
Thank you. Mike, you have the floor.
Yeah, I do think we're suffering a little bit from confusion about the terminologies, but I did want to pick up on what Liesl said about the overarching theme, which, as you said, should not refer back to the SDGs, because that really is the ultimate top-down approach. Governments of the world coming together and saying, here's what our future plan should be for development. That would not make sense to be our overarching theme. I do like Liesl's suggestion that we focus on the knowledge that will come out of a more connected world. But I also think we should focus a little on the culture. And Mexico, I know, has done a lot of interesting things in this area. We should think about what is unique to Mexico, what will be different this year than past years. And then if I could also just stress that having a few main themes is something that every international internet conference I've been to has always had. And whether it's the OECD ministerial meetings or World Bank meetings or just that this is, that you have to have some framework around which you can organize. Those themes should, I think, be designed a little bit to attract the attention of the people who aren't coming to IGFs right now. I'm one of the few people here from a Silicon Valley startup, and I can tell you that there hasn't been a lot of interest in IGFs in the past from our community, because there hasn't been a lot of talk about innovation and the future. I mean, usually we're looking at the fights that we're fighting today and not looking at ahead. So if we can be very future-oriented as we pick our overarching theme and some of our main themes, I think we would benefit a great deal. Thank you for making time.
So thank you, Madam Chair. Because I'm new, and I apologize in advance, I'm learning about the themes for the last 10 IGFs. To me, they appear very similar in wording. I'm just going to read them out loud very quickly. Athens, Internet Governance for Development; Rio de Janeiro, Internet Governance for Development; Hyderabad, Internet for All; Sharm El Sheikh, Creating Opportunities for All; Vilnius, Developing the Future Together; Nairobi, Internet as a Catalyst for Change, Access, Development, Freedoms, and Innovation; Baku, Internet Governance for Sustainable Human, Economic, and Social Development; Bali, Building Bridges, Enhancing Multistakeholder Cooperation for Growth and Sustainable Development; Istanbul, Connecting Continents for Enhanced Multistakeholder Internet Governance; João Pessoa, Evolution of Internet Governance, Empowering Sustainable Development. The reason why I'm reading this is because, to me, they're very similar in a nutshell. In summary, they talk about sustainable development, they talk about human rights and economic development per se. So I don't think we're actually going away from that topic. I capture the comment of Juan in there that we're talking about internet governance, not ICT for development. So for me, to draw a straight line from SDGs into IGF, you know, it can be done, it can be breached, yet it's a little bit pushing it too hard for, you know, end poverty. What does that mean for IGF, right? Hunger, health, education, gender, water, energy, economy and employment, et cetera, et cetera. So to me, one of the larger opportunities that we have today is to tie it into the time itself, which is the first IGF of the next 10 years, right? So what changes do we want to bring, and what do we envision for the mid and long term? And bring that forward to create kind of the first IGF of the next 10 years. Of course, it has to be tied down to the human aspect, and of course, touch upon the legislation, touch upon the geographical bridges that we have today in terms of enhancing international cooperation. But bring it back into an overall plan. That will be my take right now. Of course, I cannot put it into 10 words. I defer that to our marketing folk or, you know, smarter people than me. But I would like to tie it up to a mid to long term perspective. Thank you, Madam Chair.
No, thank you, Victor. Very helpful comments. Flavio, you were next in the queue. You have the floor.
Thank you, Lynn. Just to remember, it has been read right now by Vittoria, the main overarching theme of IGF 2015 was evolution of internet governance, empowering sustainable development. And we chose this overarching theme because of the sustainable development goals that were being defined by the United Nations in 2015. So we had already chosen this overarching theme last year. So if you are thinking of choosing something similar, we should try to modify a little bit, because it was exactly the main overarching thing last year. And if we look at the main sessions, in fact, only one of the main sessions had a direct relationship to the main overarching theme, which was internet economy and sustainable development. The other were on classical subjects such as neutrality, zero rating, and the WISIS plus 10 review process, human rights, and so on. But direct relationship to the overarching theme was only internet economy and sustainable development, just to remember.
Very helpful comments as well. Sala, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Chair. This is Sala for the record. I've just circulated something on the mailing list. I apologize if I've been spamming the mailing list this past few days. But if you open the document, you'll see in terms of popularity of themes based on calls for input in Asia Pacific. What is interesting is the topmost on the list was access, issues of access, availability, and affordability of ICT, and bridging the digital divide. Now this is at 30.43%. ICT for development, maximizing efficient use of ICT to achieve sustainable development goals was at 21.74. Critical internet resources was at 4.35%. Multilingualism was at 4.35%. IANA stewardship was zero. Human rights, issues of privacy, child online protection, intellectual property rights, freedom of information was at 8.7%. Cybersecurity in terms of national strategy, certs, critical information infrastructure protection plans, cybercrime legislation and standards was at 30.43%. Trade and e-commerce and taxation was at 0%. Now, I go back to what was the most popular being bridging the digital divide, and I'd also like to draw your attention. I've put it in a document for you. In 2014, within the Asian Pacific region, we facilitated extensive regional dialogue and discussion and preparation on this particular issue, bridging the digital divide. Government ministers, private sector, civil society, technical community, and what we discovered was from the conversation, and it's an ongoing conversation, as you can see, from back in 2014, and we're now in 2016 and it's still a prevalent issue. The layers include the following: urban and rural, old and young, meaning like the divide between the urban and the rural, old and young, men and women, rich and poor, persons with disabilities and those without disabilities, the literate and illiterate, those who participate in policy development processes and those that do not participate. Now, if you look at the last one, those who participate in policy development processes, I'll draw your attention to the WIGIG working group document. For the life of me, because of jet lag, I can't remember the year. But meaningful participation certainly was something intrinsically woven within that particular document. Now, if you look at old and young, or men and women, issues of gender, obviously you can include children and youth and that sort of thing. And in terms of persons with disabilities and those without disabilities, and if you, and somebody had already within the audience referenced discussions within the WISIS. One of the competitions that's currently being managed right now, the World Summit Award Mobile Apps Competition, is encouraging youth and developers to develop applications along the SDG focal areas. And so in terms of the comment that was made by, one of the comments made earlier in relation to the lack of interest from Silicon Valley, and also with reference to a comment made yesterday by Marilyn in relation to the potential to harness the business and the technical community that already is within Mexico. From a corridor discussion also with Cheryl yesterday about how they've been, potential synergies in terms of experiences within the US of how they run innovation competitions, and also with reference to ESIF, even within the Asia Pacific community. ESIF and Sylvia Cardina is not here, but there are already mechanisms in place, not only within Asia Pacific and across the globe, where we could synergize these sorts of things. So we're not just having the policy makers, but we're having like the innovators on the side, you know, and that sort of thing. And giving awards maybe. And so even as we're looking at timelines related to this is potentially looking at calls for competition in terms of innovative things that can actually be given just to spike up interest and that sort of thing. So to conclude, my submission for the main theme would be bridging the digital divide, and the sub-themes would be the layers that I've already outlined. And for those who'd like more reference, it's in your mailing, it's in your emails. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We have some online participants, Elizabeth and Juan, and Jivan in the back. And then Vera, were you able to update and rework the? And so we'll come to that, and then I'll try and see where we want to go with this discussion for tomorrow. So Anya, you were next with online participants.
Thank you very much. We have three interventions. Jack, you may take the floor now.
Thanks, Vera. This is Jack. I just wanted to support what Victor shared about the importance and relevance of the SDGs, considering that this is like the kickoff period for SDGs and it's for impact and global agreement towards a common goal. It seems to make sense to link IG policy concerns with the stated goals. It's important to at least speak about it for this year and to recognize that, you know, each year's IGF conversation and theme also builds on each other. It can be presented maybe as a medium to long-term perspective, just as the co-chair of the just said, now that we have a 10-year mandate for the IGF. If not as a main theme for following years, but at least this year's theme will inform the following years, either through sub-themes or tagging system. So the suggestion for a main theme is, it's a bit long, but for now, IGF and SDGs towards human rights, social, economic, and political inclusion. Having political, social, and economic inclusion is able to encompass a diverse set of issues. So, for example, internet economy and development justice also links to relevance to developing countries to participate in the IGF conversation. And then, as Salah just pointed out, access gaps is persistent in developing countries, and this theme will also build from last year's discussion. And there is great interest in the IGF community to continue in this conversation, but perhaps the link towards the SDG goals is a way to kind of also broaden it up towards a concrete objective. And there is a need to look at inclusion in a comprehensive way, so also economic, social, and cultural rights, i.e. to support, I'm a bit tired because it's kind of late, so I'm sorry if I'm not being totally coherent. But this will support IGF's work to link with other policy processes. And IGF is a key space where the discussion on internet policy and human rights evolves and mutually informs each other's policy framing, unpacking, and articulation of this issue. So to broaden the conversation on human rights from a focus on civil and political rights to emerging emphasis on economic, social, and cultural rights, also driven by the SDGs.
Thank you, Jack. Peter, you have the floor now.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I've been breathing the same air or drinking the same Kool-Aid, I think, as Victor and Juan and Ginger and a number of others. Just at the risk of repeating the point, this is an opportunity that I think we should take for IGF to stake itself out, stake out its own clearly distinct role from other organisations, and we've got 10 years to make the IGF now particularly relevant on internet-related issues, and you become relevant and you stay relevant by being authoritative and providing expertise and being comprehensive and accurate on your topics. And so for me, internet issues or the clear aspect of an internet-related issue has to continue to take priority, and I'm alerted, not concerned, but I'm alerted by the fact that Mike is reporting that a significant community like Silicon Valley, not the only community, but a significant community like Silicon Valley feels that its issues aren't being addressed. I'm sure there are others. So I'd like to just introduce or maintain this focus on some long-term planning so we're not always reinventing our entire IGF wheel at the first meeting every year. And so one suggestion is, could we reserve a meeting strand or create a meeting strand and each year deal with some of the SDGs? And of course, I mean the internet-related issues of those SDGs. If there's 17 of them, can we break them up into 5 or 6 per year? And so that everyone knows that that strand will be available for the next 2 or 3 years. We're going to be addressing the IDGs or internet-related issues of the SDGs, and look for other ways of setting out a longer-term sort of a mandate than having to do this. And I think a really significant point is the point that Flavia made very politely, which is that we are setting out these themes often and then not rigidly applying them to the actual sessions that we do. So if we can bring those things slightly more together, we will address those points that I made about being authoritative and expert and comprehensive and accurate. Thanks.
Thank you, Peter. And if I could just ask everybody to try and be brief, because one thing we do want to come back to, and Virat's now back in the room, is with a reworked timetable, because I think we should take a look at that today. So let's go back to the queue, but really ask everybody to be brief. If it's been said several times before, it's probably not necessary to repeat it.
Thank you very much. And Renata would like to make an intervention. Renata, you have the floor now.
Hi, Renata Pinviver from Brazil, from Civil Society. I would just like to support the theme Internet Governance Sustainable Development Goals towards human rights, social, economic, and political inclusion. Also, I would point out that the theme lends itself to a keyword which can be used as a hashtag, supporting also comments from CS Dialogues, WebEx, and the IGF 2015 use of descriptive hashtags. It is also important to have a long-term focus, which the theme supports. So that would be my expression of support for now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I've just been asked briefly to say that Ari is fully supporting the and endorsing Jack's team, while Ginger is saying that she's saving mic time by supporting the SDGs in IG and long-term strategy as presented by Jack and Renata. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ginger. Right now we have Elizabeth Juan Jivan. I had to close the queue after that so we can come to the timeline. This is obviously not the end of this discussion, so if anybody is left looking for Tomit, we'll come back in. But Elizabeth, you've had your flag up for quite a long time.
Thank you, and I will try and be brief because a number of people have come in with ideas that align with some of the thoughts I wanted to share. So I'll thank Salah for your analysis and suggestion. I support that. I also like the idea of the continuity and something that we can build on in the future. Somebody mentioned the Internet Economy and Sustainable Development session that we had last year, co-organized by Hossam and Anki and some other of the MAG members. This was a session that was so meaty and rich. There was so much substance, even though it was the full 3-hour session, there was much more that could be done. And what strikes me in the discussion that we're having now is that is a good place where we could continue that kind of a frame for a session could be where we then pull in those different elements of the SDGs, perhaps not as titling them, we're dealing with SDG 3, 4, and 5, which I think will probably repel a whole community of people who might not want to get so what might be perceived as sort of academic or theoretical about it, but to actually get into cases and elements that we will treat over time, over our duration, and so that we could pull in, at the time I think we were looking at practical examples, but we could make those practical examples oriented towards some of the aspects of the goals. And I'll mention that last year at the WSIS forum, a lot of mapping was done to look at how the sustainable developments relate to ICTs and the internet. We've also done some work on that at ICC, so perhaps there's some elements of that that could facilitate that work that could facilitate our selection of those pieces that could come into this.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Juan?
Thank you, Lynn. I agree 100% with Victor, the host country, that this year, that this has been renewed, we have to give a message of a powerful message. And that is the objective of the main theme. If you put in a main theme of powerful, that does not mean that you could have a workshop in spam or in other things like that. And the main theme should be not a paragraph. I'm sorry, all these suggestions that have a string of words, because it's like just putting there all the concept that you want. Maybe you can leave that for the sub-themes. The main themes have to be short, have to be elegant, and getting back to Flavio, what he said of last year, there was the mention for sustainable development, but it was the evolution of internet governance, because it was a sort of a recount of the first 10 years. Now we have to project to the future. And gentlemen, and colleagues, ladies, and last year, there have been two historic agreements. The agreement of the agenda for sustainable development is a really historic thing, and the other was the Paris Agreement in climate change, that you know it's going to be a high-level ceremony in 22 of April, that a lot of head of states are going to New York to sign this agenda, so that will pick again. So I think that we, in a way, have to get into that movement. And that does not mean that we will curtail the initiative of the workshop. Then it will be our job to classify the workshop proposals and to fit in that movement. So I will propose, I think that the host country also has have a prerogative in the main theme, because it's their country, it's the message that they want to give to the world. And I suggest to be something short. For instance, I would just put an example of how to do this. In the page where you have the Sustainable Development Goals, they have a lemma that say 17 goals to transform our world. Maybe we can get the cue there and set internet governance to transform the world or something like that. It's wide enough. Below that, in the sub-themes, we could have anything that we want, but we are getting ourselves in this thing that is historical. It's a pity that we could not have agreed the world in a nuclear disarmament, because otherwise the future would be bright. But the two agreements of late last year of developing goals, or more than development goals, because the development goals is the method to go there. It's a development agenda. It's a commitment to try to end poverty, hunger, discrimination in a world that already has sent probes to Mars. That if you think about that, that still have that, and we have internet governance, and internet, fortunately, is so transversal that can help in many things. As Salanieta knows in Fiji, internet, it's a powerful tool now for disaster recovery and assistance. Internet has become a powerful tool for in domestic violence, for reporting that and getting things done. So we don't have to be afraid of that. We can just let and see how what proposals we get. But I repeat, the main theme has to be elegant, have to be short, and have to be future-oriented, because this is the first of the next 10 years of the IGF.
Now we can be short as well. I have at least seven more speakers in the queue, and we have 15 minutes left in which to do the timetable. I think we've had high agreement on the need to certainly take advantage of the fact that this is a 10-year view we're looking at. I think everybody would completely agree with the short, simple, and elegant. I do think it needs to be somebody that incites people and gets them excited. And I think, you know, a number of the points that were made by Victor and others are, I think, well taken and well supported across the room here. If we can, for the moment, I'd like to just set that to the side come back tomorrow. We'll pick up some of the theme and sub-themes. I'm sure there'll be lots of discussion over dinner and that sort of thing. And as usually happens, probably some, what's the word I want? A burgeoning agreement or something on a small number of proposals that we can come back and review tomorrow. Because I do think it's important that we all take a look at the timeline right now. And we're clearly not going to close on themes or main themes now. So I'm happy to keep the queue. We can start with that queue tomorrow morning. But I really do think we need to go to the timetable. So if I understand correctly, I think Virat submitted a new one here to Lewis. You want to just walk us through it quickly, Virat?
Thank you, Chair. So just as it comes in, taking into consideration three main comments: extra time for Andrea's request, extra time for workshop proposals, extra time, Jack's request, extra time for MAG to evaluate, and the great gracious offer by the Secretariat to give up their time. So using all that, here's where we are. So finalizing the sub-themes is out, overarching theme is there, and yet there's a question mark. So we hope we can do that before we leave. Finalizing criteria, evaluation procedure tips, this must be done before we leave. We still go with, 9 days to formulate this. The announcement has to come in a certain format, etc. Everything has to come together. We might need a couple of days out of this room to get comments into the final, add a great tip, take out an evaluation procedure. Open call for inviting is 15th of April, 9 days from the day we end. Last date for submitting, 6th June, that is 7 weeks. Couldn't get to 8 weeks, but 7 weeks. So that's an extra week. Secretariat organizes proposals now down to 7 days from 9. They will need a little bit more time now than 5 days because we're not going with themes. So they will need an extra day or two to get this thing going. MAG completes evaluation now 3 weeks. So instead of the 2 week period, it is 4th of July, but my friends from United States can do it by the 3rd and then go on vacation. Secretariat analysis, evaluation, the workshop, 1 week, that's what we agreed to. And MAG meets 3 days after, so the list of 200 is ready. You have 3 days to just glance once what you have. When we come in here, we start the process. Two comments I would make, Madam Chair. One is, if we can organize ourselves slightly better this time in terms of the first three or four things, then we don't have to look at 40 proposals and review them. We can instead look at 20 top proposals to fix the real problems that we have, stuff that is missing. We can start slightly higher and save the time. And therefore, 3 days should be enough for looking at this. We can look at the top 20 rather than starting at the top 40, which we have done for the last decade. We should really move on that. And everything else is in sort of front of you. If 13th, 14th, and 15th of July work now, for our religious reasons, the holiday reasons, the 4th of July reasons, I think this might be a best option. It is also the last week that we can find Europeans at work. So I submit to you the joint wisdom of the MAG and the colleagues who had commented on this.
I think one of the other comment on this is it's not significantly different from the timetables we've had in the past. So it's not as though we've cut significant corners with respect to the individual blocks of time. So let me echo Virat's comment. Is there support for going forward with this timetable? Excellent. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Virat, for your
Thank
work.
Thank you, Chair.
And I know you built it off some of the work, the earlier work the Secretariat had done as well. So I think thank you to the Secretariat.
Thank you,
We have about 8 minutes left. The other, I'll come back to you in a moment, Virat. there's one fairly significant piece of work we need to get done that I'm not actually sure is a lot of work, and that is your first three, four line items there. We can ask everybody to go away and look at them. They're all online. And frankly, ask, Susan's looking a little public, but I thought they were all online and at least available to the MAG. We can make sure that they are, certainly. And we can ask everybody to take a look at them tonight or tomorrow morning, come in with some specific comments for where they might be improved on the basis of any experience we had over the last year. Or I suppose the other alternative is we get a small working group to go away tonight, tomorrow morning to look at them and come back in. But I would like to find a way to address those fairly efficiently so we can spend time on main sessions, intersessional work, and themes tomorrow, which is, I think, doable for a day, but it is, a fairly busy day in that sense. So right now I'd like kind of comments on any other proposals for how we might move forward on the first four. Again, there's quite a bit of documentation on them already. I think this is more of a minor edit. Susan, you're looking for the floor, and as you were instrumental in them last year, please.
Thank you, Chair. I would just suggest that both colleagues Virat and Liesl have circulated on the MAG list information regarding all of this documentation, so that might be an easy place to find reading material in the event that you cannot locate them online.
I suppose one other alternative is we ask everybody on the MAG to look on them online, send their comments in, and we try and manage this through an online process, as I think it's actually fairly administrative and not take up valuable face-to-face time here if people didn't want to go away and look at them this evening and tomorrow morning. So, Virat?
Yeah, I was actually going to close and give a recommendation for the first, two, three, and four, not the first one,
right.
Which was that if we could circulate these three specific documents so that people are not in the maze of online searches, look at it tonight, post their comments overnight, or by tomorrow morning, then a working group can meet tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. Some of us are meeting, but we could form a working group, consolidate the comments that are coming in, and present it to you, Madam Chair, along with the MAG, at 10 o'clock, so that we know what we are changing in each of the three documents. The only request here would be, in the efficiency of time, is to make very specific comments in case you're adding something or you're changing something. Try and avoid giving long sort of directional comments, which becomes difficult for working groups to incorporate, and that goes into a spin. If we can agree to that, then you'd both have the advantage of an online consultation overnight, and so no dinner for anybody, and sort of no breakfast for the working group tomorrow. So that is how it will work out, but at least we'll have then this closed out.
I think that's a good suggestion. And we say it's online overnight, but it's actually been a topic in front of the MAG for the last week or so. So can I just get a reaction or a support for that proposal from Virat? Again, what he's suggesting is that the Secretariat will submit those three documents so that you have them all in one place. People should review them, specific comments in terms of suggestions for changing text. I expect Virat's probably looking for some volunteers for his working group at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning, which I suspect would be here. You've got Flavio and Mike Nelson.
And I'd like to volunteer Susan to try and lead this.
So Flavio, Susan, and Mike Nelson, and Virat and Saruman, thank you.
Yeah.
Were you volunteering or were you looking for
No, I just wanted to see.
Okay. So if we can, and Cheryl, so if we can close on that and everybody meet here at 9, I'm sure he'd... And Sala as well, okay. So let me just, unless it's on that topic, Slatabon, just to make sure we're closed. Was it on that topic?
Well, it just a point of clarification. I would just want to make sure that this work does not preclude us actually from commenting tomorrow further. Just to give space, to people who perhaps are participating online or don't have the possibility to comment overnight.
Well, maybe the price of entry is you comment overnight showing that you've read it, and if you can't get it addressed, in the, then we can comment on it verbally here. But I think we need to ask people. It's been in front of the MAG for a week or so now. It's what we actually operated off of last year. I think it's a quick read and a quick edit. That's if we could...
I mean, I don't have personally any problem with this, but...
If we could just get that done and get that in before 9 o'clock local time here for the working group, then I think we should be able to move forward quickly. It's not a new piece of work in that sense.
Chair, if the working group can meet here in this room, it'd be nice, at 9 o'clock.
I have Rasha on this point, and then apparently an online participant, Anya.
It's just a question whether there is an option for the online participants to be involved in the review process.
So I think you can set up a Skype working group or something if an online participant wanted to join your working group.
WebEx, we can make a WebEx room.
The secretary can arrange
make
that.
Make a WebEx room or something, yeah.
Okay, thank you. So would somebody from the secretary be here at 9 o'clock to support the working group? Thank you.
I think they're here earlier than that as a rule.
So just so everybody's clear, the working group meets in this room at 9
o'clock. Rasha, you have the floor.
Thank you. I was just wondering if the suggestion of sharing the work is on the table, or if people are vehemently opposed to... To not having every single MAG member go through the 200-something proposal.
No, I think we said that there was a discussion for probably a virtual meeting as the next stage. How we actually rate and review the proposals is, I think, something we can push to the back end of this discussion, as long as we get the criteria out in terms of how we're going to look at the workshops and what we're looking for in terms of the proposals. I think everybody would love to find a way to not have to go through all 200. So, in fact, if you have some suggestions and want to start that discussion on the list, I'm sure we could move
forward. Sure, and I'm happy to join the working group tomorrow as well.
And we're all very excited, actually, about your proposal to do that. Wai Min, you'd like the floor?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'd just like to offer on behalf of DESTA 2 points of information really for your consideration. First is on the team. There's been a lot, I mean, I'm more referring to SDG as a whole, because the SDGs is, as in the preamble of the document, the adopted document that is universal, integrated, also interconnected. The message to all member states or all countries, to all local authorities and other stakeholders, that no one goal is a higher priority. It's actually up, of course, to the country, national authorities to decide, national and local authorities to decide which they should focus on first. Also in that in view, the ECOSOC is going to have the first high-level political forum in July, this coming July, and they, based on that, which is the same consideration that you had earlier, there was a lot of discussion, and it was adopted in March recently that the team will be ensuring that no one is left behind. So this is the team. It's actually for this year, but it's also carried forward for the future years. So this is the first point. The second point is that some of you have been involved, including Ambassador Fonseca, Lisa, and among others, in the negotiation of the WISIS Plus 10. In the preamble, there's a lot of a reference of how ICT for development, internet governance including, should be connected, integrated to SDG. At the same time, there's also a specific section on internet governance. In this document, A70/125, the outcome document, paragraph 55 to 63, which of course I will not read here. So this particular paragraph has been negotiated, discuss, also taking into consideration of multi-stakeholder on the focus emphasis of internet governance. Not necessarily the gaps, but this appears to be the most important to member state in this outcome document. So I just like to highlight these 2 points. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we're actually at 6 o'clock. I don't know that there's anything more sort of useful we could say at this point in terms of wrapping up for today, only the discussion on themes or sub-themes. I mean, I think we probably closed that about as well as we could about 15 minutes ago. Tomorrow when we come back, I will meet with the secretary and we'll figure out exactly how to sort of best structure the day. But I think one of the first things we'll do is look at the work from the working group, see if we can progress and close that. And then the major items in front of us are themes and sub-themes, and that specifically will have to address what we're prepared to put out in the call for proposals. That's a discussion that I think is best had face-to-face in here so we can go away and complete that in the coming days. We also have discussions on main sessions, possibly a short discussion on day zero, perhaps as day zero impacts opening ceremony or what we might do to create a bit more of a difference in terms of format and structure there. I think the key points we heard yesterday. I think that's primarily the work that's left ahead of us. We're coming close on kind of the preparatory calendar here. I think we need to have a discussion still on location for those. And if I'm correct, these meetings have to take place in UN premises. Is that?
Oh, a place where we have a host country agreement.
Or a place where we have a host country agreement. So we'll probably need to do some quick footwork to see if we can find appropriate venues and places and things like that. It feels like this last bit has been fairly rushed, and I don't like leaving people hanging at the mic at all. But I actually didn't know any way to move forward and close that. Most of the interventions have actually been quite long, so it means another 7 or 8 interventions would have been quite some time. Lee is just dying. He can barely sit in his chair over there, though, to say something, so.
I'll be very brief, thank you, Madam Chair. Just to say that in terms of reflecting on the themes, et cetera, tomorrow, I don't think we should also look at what's been done. I mean, the Global Commission on Internet Governance has issued a series of publications on very, very sharp themes about internet governance, both, you know, macro and micro. Very, very interesting, very dynamic. I think that these sort of things, which have great reflection, should be thought about in the context of the next 10 years. I mean, they are really something I don't know how they intersect with here, because these are publications addressed to internet governance. So how they're being considered here, and that must be part of its purpose. Thank you.
I think we need to make a distinction when we talk about themes as well. I think sometimes we're talking about the title of the conference, and other times we're talking about what's the guidance that we actually give when we go out and look for workshop proposals. Maybe we'll just end with that. I think they're both important. I think they're both needed, but I think we should be careful in our comments tomorrow to try and pull those apart where appropriate. With that, again, I'd like to thank the interpreters. We went over 4 or 5 minutes here, so I thank you for. And I have to commend as well the scribes. I mean, some of us, and I'm probably one of them, speak very, very quickly, and I just think they've done just a tremendous job. I've been in many, many meetings where there's transcription, and this, I think, has been the highest quality transcription I've seen in quite a while. Thank you to the Secretariat, and let me turn to my co-chair and see if there are any final words.
Just a final comment, and thank you all for your participation. I would like just to plant a seed in here as to who's going to host 2017. And to me, it's actually a conversation that needs to happen, you know, today or yesterday. Meaning we're struggling with the timelines, so I believe we should just start focusing on how to engage the next countries as to continue the planning sessions. Thank you.
I think we would all support that. Thank you, everybody. Have a good evening, and we'll see you back here tomorrow at 10:00.